Hey, everybody. You're back with Dave and Ed. This is episode 4 of To the Death podcast.
And we just recorded the most amount of time we ever done in one shot. That's with my grandmaster sensei, Yanni Hronakis.
I'll let you call him that, I suppose.
He was fantastic on this episode. He backs up everything I've been saying so far. He's agreed with me on every point. Barely agreed with you on anything. Charity.
Listen, sometimes you have to disagree with people. Opposites attract is what I've been trying to tell you.
Yanni's literally sitting here next to us smiling because he knows I'm right.
No, he knows I'm right. What is the matter with you? You're not even reading him properly.
All right,
we did get to the bottom of our California trip, and H will be coming with me to AOJ.
Are you going to like give away everything? First of all, he never said he was going to do that. And second of all, they'll hear about...
I'm inferring it and just giving the people a little taste.
All right, we'll let the people decide. As well as we talk about Yanni's whole start to present.
And you find out who's better at jiu-jitsu, me or Ed.
Yeah. So I hope you guys enjoy. This is To the Death podcast, episode 4. All right, here we are with Yanni. First question I got to ask you, who is better at jiu-jitsu, Ed or Dave?
Ed.
Oh my God. I thought we were friends, H.
We're not.
No, this definitely has to be challenged, all right? Ed, look at the size of him. He's barely even a human. How is his jiu-jitsu better than mine?
Well, it is, you know, his weight.
No way, no way.
Thank you.
Dave, tell him, how heavy are you right now?
I don't want to talk about it.
He's
all right?
basically the same size.
But I'm still lighter than you. We're still not even in the same weight class.
How would you describe how I'm better? It's not just size. You know it's not size.
He said size. We're going with size.
Size is a factor. Fine.
Ed loves to just squeeze you to death. He's got a great squeeze. Real good squeeze.
He talks about how good he's going to be when he's 180 pounds. Do you think he's still going to have that fat squeeze when he's light?
Come on. I'm still strong.
Ed did master the protect the arm bar with the figure four to the death. So I feel like those years of training with Derek Doyle who...
hold on, Dave. Dave looks like he wants to speak, but hold on. How many times in the past 10 years do you think he's tapped me out?
If I were to guess, I don't know, once, twice?
Zero times.
Zero times.
The closest I've came was when I had him in crucifix position.
And he gave it up to take the back instead, like you would do.
You suggested that, yes.
Yeah, you did suggest that, but you should have finished me right there.
You should have. You should have at least done it once just so that you had something to
He was too fat for me. He's out of my weight class. We're training in an absolute division when I'm training with him.
That situation happened on a big layoff. Like I was super heavy. It was like the first day back. And he still couldn't get me.
So you mean every time you train? Because every time you train is after a big layoff.
Not every time. He doesn't even know. Yanni, he hasn't rolled with me at 170. In a long time. Tell him what I'm like at 170.
He's been talking about this since I've known him.
The truth is, when Ed does get on like your back or something like that, when he's in shape, ready to attack, and his grips are strong, he's dangerous for sure.
But is he more dangerous at 170 or fat like he's been for the however many years?
Like danger, like
to finish
for sure when he's at 170.
That's right, mother lover.
When was the last time you saw Fat Ed at 170? Give me a year. Was it 2009?
No, it's after that.
Come on.
I don't know. When were you a purple belt? I guess.
Yeah, when I was a purple belt.
And that was 2011. 12?
I got it at 12, and I stayed in shape for maybe 2014.
No, I met you in 2014. You were fat.
Yeah, but I had these intermittent periods, whatever. We're not talking about how fat I am. What I did want to talk about was we're going to have a show match, right?
We are going to have a show match. Now, what happens when I destroy, is Ed your top student? What happens when I destroy your top student?
I'll just start sending people out.
Who would you send next?
Next is Joe, since I heard how Joe whoops on you.
Oh my God.
Joe does whoop on me. What is that about?
Joe loves jiu-jitsu, man.
Oh my God. You haven't seen him whoop on me, though.
I haven't seen it.
No, you've only heard about it. Yeah, because I'm just being nice to Joe, though.
Just for those who don't remember, Joe is a blue belt.
Joe is a blue belt. Yeah, but the last time you talked about Joe, he's built like a Greek god.
He is built strong.
Right. Joe's a hard worker. He loves working out like crazy, you know. He made
just like me.
All right, so I want you to be a part of this. You got to be a part of our show match. We need a referee. He said we don't need a referee. Don't we need a referee to stand on the outside?
Oh, so we're going to have your grandmaster sensei ref our match, and that's supposed to be...
What are you saying? He's not...
Wait, is this a points match or a...
Yeah, this is IBJJF.
A master's 5 minutes.
I will be honest. I probably would be the better ref out of anyone you guys know. But.
Better than you, for sure.
No, wait a second, though. But his opinion is biased.
No, it's not.
Yeah, he's not going to be awarding me points when I get my points.
Of course he would. Yanni is the most honorable man I know.
I need somebody that's going, for me, for my side.
You could have a coach. You need a coach.
How about we do?
I don't need a coach. I need somebody that's going to second guess Yanni's points awarding.
How about we go IBJJF
triple
final
ref.
With three refs?
Who's the other three two refs? You get to, we each got a choice, or you want both of them? You can have both of them. I don't care.
I don't know anybody in those rules. Who did we just suggest knew the rules last time?
You suggested nobody. You suggested yourself as
perfect.
The most
I'm the other two refs.
No.
Yeah. Every single thing. Like this. No. Take them back.
Did you know that?
Take them back.
Dave hates advantages. He thinks advantages are stupid.
I didn't say that.
I said you prefer...
I like grappling industries with no advantages.
What do you think, Yanni?
Well, I believe that advantages have their place for sure.
They
for
have
sure.
their place, but how, what do you feel about grappling industries, no advantages?
I feel that you can be destroying someone for the entire match, but the other person held on, and then it would be a tie. And then
wait, don't you think refs' decisions should be lessened? Like,
wait,
the less, the better.
I have a quick question, just based on this. How did you feel about Keenan versus Marigali? Marigali had like 9 or 10 advantages to Keenan's one sweep. What do you think about that? What do you think about that?
What was that?
Choking. I'm choking to death. Let me drink my coffee. Ed hates it.
Yeah, well, like I said, not like I said. The truth is, Keenan did everything. He gamed the match for sure, and he played to the points because he scored the two, and then Marigali. But Marigali had him on the run. Keenan was definitely playing the defensive in that match.
Right. Looking from the outside, you know nothing about jiu-jitsu.
Why would
Keenan
you even watch?
Lost.
Yeah, but why would you even watch?
But that's what I'm saying.
That's one of the problems with jiu-jitsu.
No advantages.
No. Listen, any system you put in place, are they going to game
it?
Just
for this. No, we're going to game it.
Yeah,
oh, we're doing IBJJF? I'm winning by advantages on you, Ed.
Your argument is actually for advantages.
I know. I understand that now.
That's why
I stopped talking.
Oh, my God. All right.
You're right. Advantages are better. I can't.
You're right, Dave. You actually win.
So listen, after I take out your star pupil, then what?
I don't know.
I would need
Are you
going to
take his belt away?
No.
Are you going to take his belt away?
Let's just say the 99% chance I'm going to win. The 1% chance, maybe I get hurt or something.
No, I'm
going
to take him down. I'm going to take Ed down.
Do you think he can take me down?
And then I'm going to stall on top. He's taught me how.
Ed hates takedowns.
Thank you very much.
I would be surprised if he took him down.
Ooh.
Yanni, what is going on right now? I've known you since 2006.
This is true.
Yeah.
I've known you longer.
So?
You came to my wedding.
He came to my wedding, too?
Yeah, I came to both of your weddings.
But he danced at my wedding.
I told you he danced at my wedding.
I don't know if I remember dancing at either wedding.
Well, anyways, this is going to be videotaped, and then
ooh,
we're going to watch it.
And we're going to put it up for everyone
to
watch.
We're going to have multiple camera angles.
Oh, yeah, it's going to be real high class. But we're going to have to wait a little bit to do this. Or we can get some people in here.
Are we doing a catch
weight,
or are you going to try and lose weight?
We could do a good live stream and...
No, it's definitely not going to be live stream because we're going to have to edit it to my approval.
There's nothing to prove. How are you going to prove an over-under pass into an armbar?
No, it's not going to happen. Jimmy, if you're listening, I need help with my over-under defense.
He doesn't know how to stop over-under. Jimmy knows how to do over-under.
Well, then I'm just going to have to start training with him.
You should ask my Grandmaster Sensei, who knows exactly how to stop.
Oh, but you just said he's your Grandmaster Sensei.
I know, he would never.
Will you coach me for this match?
Of course not, he would not do that. That's against the rules. He's the rep. He's not coaching me either. He's just going to laugh at you while you're losing. Isn't that your favorite when, like, you're watching somebody that you've trained in a match and they're just dominating? You just got to sit there.
Oh, that's
no pressure.
The best. Actually, you know what? I, a long time ago, was watching Lloyd Irvin coaching Ryan Hall at a tournament back in the day. And Ryan Hall was super relaxed. He was just, like, laying there, like, obviously, you know, beating the guy. The guy he was going against, obviously, was probably, like, nervous. And Lloyd was sitting back. Every once in a while, he would, like, lean in and put his hand by. It looks like he's whispering something. But it was just, like, an eye-opening moment for me as a coach because I would be like, I would love for me not to have to scream my head off.
Right, the
coach.
People that get the most notoriety are usually the coaches that are screaming and getting into it, like somebody's instructor. My instructor's super chill.
I've never seen H yell on the sideline.
Of course, but he's not your instructor. Your instructor is very animated. And
listen to me right now, all right? So, what happens when I send you a text message asking about a technique?
You know, I'm
do
like,
you facepalm? I want to know if you facepalm.
There might be a facepalm. I don't know. Depends on the question.
What? How about an inward?
This is abusive right
how
now.
How about an inward eye roll? Like, you don't actually roll your eyes, but inward, you're like, ugh.
I don't know what that means.
Just a feeling of disgust when you see my name pop up on the screen. Is that what happens?
It depends on how long it's been since you messaged me. If it's been a long time, be like, oh, this is going to be dumb. This is. But if I seen you recently, I'd be like, oh, okay.
Has this ever happened to you? You're like, you ever have like a somebody you're talking to or you're waiting for a text? Like, oh, and then you get this guy's text instead of that text? I've had that happen before.
This is becoming abusive right now. Mm-hmm. I need somebody here on my team right now. Somebody on my side helping me.
You ever get frustrated, Yanni, like teaching?
Nah.
That's a lie.
You guys should see his face right now. Hang on, I'm taking a picture.
I set you up. Not him specifically. What are you doing?
Oh, no. Don't look at me.
I've seen Yanni, like, even if they're not rolling, like, telling somebody a technique, especially a white belt. And you tell them to move, like, all right, put your left hand here, and they move their right leg. Like,
yeah.
Something like that.
Oh, yeah.
That stuff gets Yanni crazy.
Yeah, you're probably right. Definitely right.
Or if they're rolling, and he tells them the exact thing to do to fix it, and they don't do it, and he just like, puts his hands up, like, I can't.
I usually just kick them over. I'm like, I can't believe I've wasted my time. I've wasted 20 years perfecting my art for you to just...
He's for sure done that.
Destroyed it.
Kicked you over?
Not kicked me over, but just like, come on.
Oh, yeah. I've seen him roll his eyes at you. Usually like, it's just at your weight.
All right. I think we've talked enough about us.
Well, no. Right. I have another question.
We'll get back to it.
Oh.
Is it good?
I just want to know, what are you going to do when Ed starts training again? Are you going to take his belt away or stripes away? Do you see a black belt in his future?
I think everyone can get a black belt eventually.
What a political answer. I love it.
That's so positive.
Is that positive?
Yeah, he's telling me I'm going to get one.
One day.
If I keep training, which
I believe
do.
In him.
See?
But he does break my heart often by not coming after a month or whatever.
That was another question. What happens when Ed takes a layoff? Does a little piece of you die?
You don't have to make it about me. About anybody. I'm not the only person you've ever had take a layoff. What do you think about people that take layoffs in general? Have you ever taken a layoff? Like, not injury?
Non-injury layoff? No.
So what do you think about people that take layoffs?
It makes me sad often because I'm like, they could be so much better. But the truth is, everyone, like... It's up to them to like want to have that passion. Like I just can't see myself not coming to class every week.
But do you think that's part of your job is to motivate them to come? Or do you think it's on them?
That's a tough one. I mean, there probably was a time where I kind of thought, oh, I should be motivating people. But the truth is...
People just spit right in your face.
People can't be motivated. If they either want to do it or they don't. And... They'll tell you to your face that, oh, yeah, I'm going to make all these promises, but unless they really...
But can I give you a counter argument? From my perspective, from somebody that takes off...
A lot.
When you text me, when I'm in the midst of like a 1 to 2 month layoff, and you say, hey, what's up? Just that, I'm like, oh, my God. You shame me. I got to come now. And I many times have come like the next day or that same day just from a text like that. Now, maybe I'm a specific person, but...
Yeah, probably, but I sometimes feel guilty doing it. I'm like, no, I shouldn't. Ed should want to do this.
I love sending messages when people take layoffs. If I don't see somebody, I love sending them a message. And usually I just send a poop emoji, and I let them figure it out.
That's because you have no shame, though.
Yeah, right.
Yanni has a conscience. He feels bad.
Well, when it comes to you, he definitely shouldn't.
Why?
Have a conscience?
What do you mean? He's known me so long.
Do
you want to see me get to the pinnacle?
Absolutely.
See?
Absolutely.
Do you want to see me get to the pinnacle?
Yes, of course.
There's a slight pause there. I'm not.
There was a pause.
I'm not going to edit that pause.
Yeah.
Speed that pause up.
Let's start it right from the beginning. What year did you start training Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu?
I started training Jiu-Jitsu. Actually, I had some previous a little. So I started with Taekwondo, obviously. And I had watched like a Gracie in action as a teenager. Excuse me. As a teenager. I must have been like 15, 16, so that's like 95, 96, and I was aware of it. But I didn't actually start learning formally jiu-jitsu. Like my instructor, George Cernak, owns Enzo Gracie Denville, he like sometimes would have us just roll like in the Taekwondo program.
Hilarious.
And like we would do like self-defense where we would like block a punch, take each other down, do an armbar. And then a few times I like rolled without knowing much, but I think I formally started learning jiu-jitsu in 99.
Did you watch the first UFCs or you didn't, weren't even aware of them?
I wasn't that aware of them, except I think a year or two before I started training, I had like ordered a pay-per-view. It was like UFC 1-6. It was like 6 hours long.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and it had like all these matches. I think it started from like the first one, and then I remember like Tank Abbott being on it as well. And then at the time, I was aware of what jiu-jitsu was and like the arm bars, but I didn't really... I was like, oh, this guy can fight off his back, and he just like yanks on the guy's arm and he taps.
So I just want to help people with a quick little timeline. So you started formally in 99. Had you graduated high school at this point?
Yes.
Okay.
So
just out of high school.
This is
before, 98 I graduated.
This is before both of us. So what was the class like there? How many people were training like your first day of class? Who was the teacher?
Yeah, I
mean, or was it just like more casual, like kind of an open mat thing?
It was pretty casual. Actually, you know what? When we first started our program, we had Rodrigo Gracie do a seminar.
Oh, wow.
So we had like, I want to say about 10 people in. And I remember he showed, I don't know if I can remember the techniques, but I remember there being like the arm bar from the guard, which is something I really wanted to learn since I saw like Hoist Gracie pull off like an arm bar from the bottom. And I just thought there was something really magical and mystical. And when I remember showing it and then climbing the leg up and throwing the leg over, I was like, no, there's more to this. It's like, I'm...
All right, wait, let's take one step back though. So you were doing Taekwondo since you were a little kid.
Yeah.
Were you ever like super attached to Taekwondo specifically? And like, oh, my art's better than your art? Oh,
absolutely. In fact, I had seen like, what is it, Gracie in Action?
And challenge matches.
Yeah. And then in the beginning of it, when he was just like talking about general martial arts, I was assuming he was going to say how Taekwondo was the best one just because that was the
you
one.
Thought he was just going to say it?
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
That's because you were in the original echo chamber where like you're only around Taekwondo people.
Yeah. Why would another martial art be better? That thought never crossed my mind. Like, and I never thought to myself, it's not like at 8 years old, I was... looking on the internet that didn't exist to see what the best martial art was. You know, my parents was just like, hey, how about this guy over here? He's in our same town. Let's...
Wow, that's really like rolling the dice.
Look how that formed your whole life now.
Yeah, it did.
Wait,
did
your parents have any martial arts experience?
No.
Oh, they were just looking for you. All right, we got to get this kid out of the house.
Yeah, they just needed me to do something, so...
But you obviously were obsessive about Taekwondo.
Yeah, I really liked it. I was like... part of the program, even teaching by the time I was like 14.
So this really should have shook your world when you watch this video and you're like, wait a minute.
Yeah, at first I was just like most people would have been like...
In denial.
No, yeah, in denial, 100% denial. I was like, he's lying about something, you know, this, that, and the other. And then I kind of like watched that UFC years later and I'd be like, oh, wow, there's like... You know, if someone really does take you to the ground and you don't know what you're doing, you're kind of like, you're in a pool with a shark. Yeah,
I'm sure like when you first rolled, your first day, it really just snapped it into place. Like, yeah, this is, right? This is where I should be?
That's one of my questions. What kept you with jiu-jitsu if you're already doubting it?
Oh, no, it's not that I had doubted it. By the time I started jiu-jitsu, I knew that I had wanted to learn it.
Okay.
I don't know if I was that crazy about it, but one thing I did love about it right at the beginning was like I saw like really like the better guys be able to roll without using a lot of strength versus all the white belts I would be training with, and we were all just trying to kill
like
each other.
It's kind of like proof of concept, like math. Like if you do this, this is going to happen. Like I could prove it
right away.
And I was already teaching classes, of course, in Taekwondo, and we would teach like self-defense and... And I was big on like making sure everyone was doing the moves right according to the way I knew it at the time.
So what about another aspect of this is not only are you doing a brand new martial art, I mean, you're a black belt in Taekwondo at this point.
Yeah.
Right. And now you're going to humble yourself and go all the way to white. Were you like, or like, should I be more? Or were you just like, I'm starting from scratch. This is.
Yeah, I was definitely, I'm starting from scratch. I never really, I always try to stay humble. Even like shortly after I started jiu-jitsu, when George's instructor, Rich Rossidi, had taken over, he brought in a Muay Thai instructor, and I decided also to try out Muay Thai. And even when I would spar in Muay Thai, you know, I would, like, everyone would be telling me, like, oh, you should be using all the Taekwondo kicks you can, you know, in sparring. But I was like, well, I suck at defending leg kicks, and I suck at not getting punched in the face over and over. So I was like, let me try to, like, learn the proper details there. And I made sure, like, I wasn't using what I already knew. I was trying to, like, learn, like,
this is that is just an amazing, amazing thing. Yeah. At such a young age, you're already trying to strengthen your weaknesses.
Because even in jiu-jitsu, like, people have only done jiu-jitsu even for the past 20 years, like you. You know, they're playing tried and true mostly. Maybe they'll dabble in other things just to teach it, but they're not literally adding it to their game and changing their whole game. You know, because you leave up opening. Anytime you change your game or try something new, you're opening yourself up to get crushed.
Yeah. Right? Here he is, a master of kicks, learning new kicks after already being a master of kicks. That's just like the jiu-jitsu.
I remember one time it dawned on me, like, the mentality of learning. It was just like me and like two other guys, and they were definitely better than me, but we were just doing passing guard drills. And I noticed that every time I would play guard, nothing would happen. The person would be like this with the elbows in really tight. And as soon as I would open my legs to try to do something, they would pass. And it was frustrating at first. And then on top, I would sometimes get submitted because I was the one trying to open the legs. But then I thought to myself, it's like, well, if I keep trying, hopefully, you know, hopefully I can force the person to make mistakes and stuff like that. And then I noticed, like, the same people I was training with months later, they were playing the same stalling tactics, and I was just doing better against them. Before you know it, I was like, I was more confident in my attacks than they were, because they were just, like, more about winning the individual role. And I was thinking, I was like, what do I have to do at this exact moment? And I think that's something a lot of people have to learn, you know.
That's amazing to know at such at such a young age at that point. There's adults now that can't grasp that concept.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. To me, it makes sense. You know, you're not going to get better unless you try.
Well, you were actually in a more unique situation than now. Somebody that's a white belt now, think about how the game is fully evolved.
Yeah.
How many techniques there are, access to techniques, so the game's getting better faster. When you were back then, I mean, what was the role like? Like, how many different types of guards were there that you were playing, learning?
Yeah, as far as guards, it was just basic, your closed guard, you know, there's some half guard and butterfly stuff.
You know what's hilarious, though, is how in the past year or so, how you went back to closed guard and are really taking that to another level, kind of switching through your other guards that you've learned.
I actually remember a specific moment as a white belt where I got fed up with closed guard.
I hit that point, too.
I remember being a white belt, but I was, like, you know, about 8 or 9 months into training, so I was better than most of the other white belts in the class that were newer, you know? And there's one newer guy who was just bigger than me, taller, more athletic. I don't know if he had any martial arts experience, like wrestling or anything, but it was just me and him training. We literally rolled for maybe a half hour straight, and I wasn't able to sweep him, and I kept getting him into, like, arm bars and triangles, and he would get out of them. And maybe eventually I got on top and armbarred him after, like, a half hour roll. Like,
what are you talking about? There was no 5 minute timer. Why didn't
you
switch?
There was no timer. I don't think that those things even existed. I didn't pull up my cell phone either.
No smartphone at that point.
No smartphone.
Yeah, but then the boxing timers you used to have one of those, I remember.
Oh, that's way after, dude.
Yeah,
that's definitely way after. We didn't have a timer.
So how many guys were in class? What were you doing? How many color belts are there when you start?
Only guys who were visiting from Henzo's were colored belts.
Were you wearing a gi at this point? Because you wore no gi for a long time.
Yeah, I was wearing a gi, yeah. And I was training with a guy, I think we were actually training no gi, and he kept getting out of everything. And I got so frustrated. And then I started, like, understanding, because I would watch Jamie roll. Jamie Cruz, one of my instructors, my main instructor right now. He was big on butterfly guard, and he would sweep and get on top, then I'll be like, maybe I should just look to get on top instead of trying to submit from closed guard, because my legs were getting tired. And the last thing I wanted was a guy with a weak experience to beat me. And
that's, man, that's a brutal way to have to learn all those easy lessons that you can just say now. Like, right? You're learning the hard way before YouTube. There's no YouTube jiu-jitsu.
No. I think when I was, like, around a blue belt, there was this website, onthemat.com. I don't even know if that website is still around. But on the mat would have matches, and it was like quick time matches. I was on dial up, and we would download the videos were like this big. If you put it full screen, it would be like
pixels. All blurry.
It would be giant pixels. But I remember watching Dean Lister do like a rear naked choke from a crucifix position.
Oh, wow.
And just be like, oh, I've never thought to do that. Let me try that. And then the next day I would try it. And then I saw, I think it was like Dave Camarillo do like a knee bar.
Wasn't that the guy BJ Penn was training with?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Or Dave Camarillo. He's a very high-level judo guy, was a half Gracie black belt. I think recently he even did a seminar at like Marcelo's and stuff like that, because he was, I think, Paul Schreiner's coach before Paul Schreiner moved out.
What's crazy is hearing you talk about this. Obviously, me and Dave met you when you were pretty established. I mean, everybody yeah. looked to you. And it's funny to hear like how the struggles. Like, how long were you a white belt for?
Well, I'm also interested. So what year was this on the mat period that you're talking about?
It's hard to say. I want to say I was definitely a blue belt. So it took me a little under 2 years to get my blue belt. So
wait, when you got promoted, how was your blue belt promotion? Was it a class, a seminar?
Seminar.
You went to Henzo's?
It was a seminar here.
Oh, here.
When it was Cernax Karate back in the day.
Wow, what year was that?
Jeez, gotta be 2001 or 2000, maybe late 2000.
2000.
So in this building.
Yeah.
You've been in this building how many years?
Since 98.
Wow.
So now we're talking about late 2000. All the way back then, you've already been studying match videos.
Oh yeah, I was studying. There wasn't a whole lot, but on the mat, would post like videos, and I would see it. I remember watching even Ricardo Almeida versus Margarita. That was like an old match that I had watched, and I was one thing I saw Margarita do that was something that I really liked at that time was he was like sitting up, and then Ricardo was trying to pass his guard, and he just does like a cross collar from like a sitting guard, no, not a closed guard. And he scared him enough to get on top and get 2 points and then almost like submits him with it. And then I was like, man, he just got up and just like, you know, threatened with the choke, used it in not necessarily to submit him, but to like get on top. That's when I started realizing that not all moves are like what they look like on the surface, right? Like a submission, yes, you want to make the person tap out, but sometimes you use a submission to back someone away.
Right, like kind of, that's how I use guillotines because I can't ever finish them. But if I can get around somebody's neck just enough to get them away from me, maybe yes. Pressuring too much.
Exactly, and then back away, and then you can control their hands. And I remember that match, seeing that. Like I said, Dave Camarillo doing like a knee bar from top half guard because sometimes, like at that time, I would get frustrated passing. And then I was like, oh, this is easy. And I think I actually like tapped someone out in class. And then I tried it on Jamie, and Jamie just like off-balanced me, and then knee barred me right back, and then like
that's what happens with leg locks. You gotta go for them. All right, you want to play this game?
Well, Jamie used to teach me those lessons a lot. Like I was a big fan of Sakuraba. You know, he used to fight in the Prides, he fought all the Gracies and stuff. He impressed me with his Kimura to armbar transitions, which I guess you kind of learned, but not like Sakuraba was basically doing like Kimura trap stuff. This is like 2001.
So 20 years later, we're still doing Kimura traps.
I know. And then the funny thing is I was like a brand new blue belt. So this might be like late 2000, early 2001. And then I had seen a video where Sakuraba used a Kimura to go into an armbar. I would like purposely start my roll without a guard against like white belts. And then as they would try to get side control, I would use a Kimura, throw my legs around and get an armbar. And I think I got it once or twice. And I was like, well, this is the next move that I'm going to be known for.
this is my signature move.
Yeah, thinking no one's going to be able to beat this. And then I go roll with Jamie. And it didn't matter. Jamie would kill me every time we rolled anyway, you know. And then I would just try to say that. I was like, oh, you know, baited him to go to side control. I'd lock him the Kimura, and then he walked around and armbarred me.
Matt Hughes style.
Matt Hughes versus James George St. Pierre.
George St. Pierre, that's right. That was a great match.
And he did it at least two or three times, and then finally said to me, it's like, Like, you can't do it when you don't have a guard yet. And he explains, like, I'm going to do this counter to you every time you try that. And I thought to myself, I remember thinking to myself, like, no, I just got to get better at it. I just got to get better.
That's what everyone thinks when something doesn't work.
Of course.
No, it's going to work. I'll just keep trying it.
And then I realized, like, oh, it's because I don't have my legs involved at all. I'm just using my arms, and then I'm throwing my legs at the last second. Like,
this is why I'll never be a black belt, because I still do stuff like that.
Agreed.
Just not utilizing my legs when I should be. Yeah. All arms. My arms could do everything.
That's just because your belly's in the way, though.
My belly is in the way. Anyway, so on the thing about promotions, like, you came from Taekwondo, which is way different belt system than Jiu-Jitsu.
Yeah.
What was it like for you to have to wait 2 years and just get your blue belt? Like, what was that like for you?
Were there stripes?
You know what? Everyone was a white belt when I started,
right. You
know? George was already a blue belt. Jamie had, when I first started, I think Jamie was still a blue belt, but got his purple belt like a month later. But I just looked to them. It's like, all right, blue belts, they're just way better. And I just assumed that because you had the belt longer, that the belt level didn't matter. I understood that right away.
Right away, you're just like, these belts... Silly.
In fact, it was refreshing, to be honest.
Really?
Know? Yeah. Yeah, because although I was very proud of, you know, my black belt, but you have to think, I was like 15 years old, and adults would come in and call me Mr. H or Sir.
Yeah, it's kind of
weird. I liked it, I think, at the time. But once I started doing jiu-jitsu, I saw how, like, everyone was laid back. Even Rodrigo, when he taught the seminar, was super laid back. Everyone called him by his first name.
Do you think, Keenan was talking about this on this podcast, about, do you think that's the Brazilian culture, or you think it's just the culture of jiu-jitsu in general, that kind of laid back?
I would say it's probably more the Brazilian culture.
Right.
Yeah. Probably at the time, I just assumed it was a jiu-jitsu thing, but I, you know, going through the years, I understand that it really is a Brazilian thing, you know? Because even that seminar, Hajigo came like 45 minutes late, and that was like, that was like shocking to me. It's like, where is this guy? Is he even going to show up, you know? And then and then when he came in and taught, of course, I was very interested in learning. So I was like super stoked to see him there, you know? But I think most people, like, if you weren't really like engaged in learning jiu-jitsu, you probably would have been like really turned off by that.
Was that like a regular seminar the way they are now, like long 3 hours?
Yeah, I think it was around 3 hours.
You roll with
him
or no?
I don't think, no, he didn't roll, I don't think.
Well, we were talking about that last.
Right.
What do you think about rolling at seminars and stuff like that?
I mean, it depends. I think it's cool to roll with the person who comes, especially if it's, if you get a chance to roll with someone at that level and you don't normally have someone at that level at your gym, you know? I think that's great. I don't think it's necessary, though, because it depends on what your purpose of the seminar is. If you want to learn their game, and then just having them in the room and getting a chance to ask them those questions, I think it's very valuable, you know?
Can you imagine all the people that you've rolled with now compared to then? Like, think about the high-level people you've rolled with since.
Yes.
And that you used to think Jamie was a god at purple, a new purple belt. Now you get to roll with these world-class black belts.
Exactly. It's kind of funny how, like, the standards just change, and you don't see it happen. It's granular. It happens slowly, you know? I actually remember there being a blue belt. It was actually one of Jamie's friends who used to like show up every once in a while. He was from Henzo's, and he was real mean to everyone he rolled with. He would do like these neon belly, like really, like he would do it violently, and like, and he would put your, like, I remember he used to like switch neon bellies and just kind of always pull people in, and he would just destroy me, you know. And then, but he was like a pilot or something, and he would not, he would have to take like time off from training. And then one day he came and visited, and I just had a war with him where he would always kill me. And I had a war with him. I don't remember what happened. And then the next time after that, I rolled with him. I swept him, mounted him the whole time. I think I finally submitted with an armbar.
And you told him to quit jiu-jitsu. You're like, you're not good. Just stop.
He doesn't say things like that. I would have heard it already.
I wish you would. Sometimes I wish you would just like spike the football once in a while.
No, for sure. But I remember that was huge for my confidence, to make me think that, oh, I'm actually am getting better. It's hard to see it because
it's
the
so
people
hard.
People you're getting, you're training with every day, the other white belts and new blue belts, we're all...
You rise together. It's like the tide rises all ships.
Exactly. And we all get better, sometimes at different rates, sometimes someone else has like spikes when I'm having a valley, you know, peaks and valleys.
Or you're trying one of your new techniques and it's really not working out, and then it hurts the ego a lot.
Yeah. And then I was very surprised that I was like at his level now. And then I thought to myself, I was like, well, it makes sense. He's taking breaks and I'm not. So I should be getting better. If this is like a scientific method, I should be getting better.
So I should be getting better than Ed.
Isn't that sad that he's still not better than me? I take all these breaks. He hasn't taken a break in how many years?
So what's the problem, Dave?
Listen, I'm going to fix all my problems. All right. Are you available for private lessons right now?
He doesn't do privates except for Ari.
Ari's my only private
I have green money, all right? Oh, we dear. All need some of that right now.
It's going to cost you a little extra.
That's fine. I'll pay the extra. Let's do it. All right. We're going to call this my black market training for our little secret
match. All right. So you're a blue belt now. Was it blue belt your longest belt?
Yes.
That's crazy.
Other than black belt.
But why was that?
I don't know. I know that I feel that at that time, at least for me, I didn't think like, I would think that purple belt was just
unattainable.
Unattainable, yeah. Right? Purple belt was unattainable at that time. And the only purple belt I would train with in that time was Jamie. And Jamie was just way ahead of us at the time. And I was just, I honestly didn't really care about getting promoted because I was just like, well, I got to get to like black belt level and stuff like that, you know? And these days, you know, you can get better much faster because there's a lot more training available too. You know, I think we had classes like 3 times a week, and I think I would do an open mat. So I was training 3 to 4 times a week, but that was like a lot.
You think about these animals now, even people you've trained that train twice a day, they're going to other schools with these top competitors, the blue belt tournaments that are going on right now. Imagine if you roll with a blue belt.
Like when, we were talking about
when you
last
got
time.
Your black belt.
Yeah.
That's great. It would be the toughest role.
Yeah, absolutely. Just like I was all about Team Taekwondo when I was like a kid. Everyone was all about like, oh, it's Team Henzo. There's Yamazaki here in the East Coast, you know, and then on the West Coast, you had like Halfs and stuff like that. It was pretty wild. I remember my first tournament. It was a Grappler's Quest, and there was a super fight division, and I think Nick Serra might have won it, or don't really remember that well, but I remember Nick Serra was like a name I had heard of Matt Serra, and then when they said Nick Serra, I was like, oh, it's another guy from Henzo's. I've heard of this guy just because Jamie would talk about it, George would talk about the Serra brothers, how amazing they were.
So a tournament back then, like how many people did you show up to?
You know what? My first tournament, I had a good like 16 guys maybe in my division.
Was this white belt or blue belt for your first tournament?
It was a white belt, or it was a no-gi beginner division. So whatever that is, a year and a half, up to a year and a half of training. And I remember I did pretty well at that tournament. Like I was not expecting to do well. My first match, I went against a wrestler who had wrestling shoes, big guy. And I immediately thought to myself that like, I'm going to get taken down. So I just like pretended to shoot a really bad double leg and then pulled guard. And I was like, all right, this is my match. And then my whole goal was to get an advantage. I was aware of advantages at that time.
Back to advantages, yeah. Trying to win on advantage.
I actually had intended on winning on advantages because I was like, I bet you I can get this guy in like a triangle and then I'll just go back to guard. And that's basically what happened. I had him in a triangle. I went to a triangle armbar really quickly. But the guy just picked me up really like off the ground, so I just let go of it. I was also very scared of getting slammed in a tournament.
Yeah, but did they have any, what were the rules back then?
I don't think there were rules.
It's the learning stages. They probably weren't aware.
I don't think I don't think they cared about you slamming. I think shortly afterwards, there was like Brian Simmons had gotten, you know, owner of Grappler's Quest, got slammed viciously on his neck.
That's when he injured himself, right?
Yeah, and that's when he made that rule that you couldn't slam. But I just thought to myself, like, well, I don't want to get slammed, and this guy is way bigger and stronger than me.
Wait, what weight class is this?
This was like 179, but I definitely shouldn't have been at 179.
Well, you weren't jacked back then? You weren't doing squats and stuff?
Not at all. And the guy just like lifted me up like as soon as I went for it. With about a minute left in the match, I looked at the scoreboard. And I was like, did I get an advantage early in the match? I saw it and I was like, oh, okay. I'll just make sure I don't get my guard path. And then my other I had like three other matches that day. Next two matches, I think I got an arm bar from Mount. And then my third match, I went against a guy from Endgame, which was this one school. And it's still around. Or I don't know if it's still around, but in Lodi. And they were like more of an MMA guy, MMA gym, where I was just thinking, like, oh, they're not jiu-jitsu, so I should be able to be more technical. And the guy went for a toe hold on me.
Oh, toe hold.
In the beginner division.
Yeah, yeah.
Cheater.
And I think I went for it right back. Like, I just grabbed his foot and started yanking. But I literally felt, like, things happening in my leg. And then I ended up getting mount from there, like, just, like, ignoring the submission, getting mount. And I think I did submit him with an arm bar. And then I remember the next day, I felt like my knee was a little bit jacked up for at least for a couple of weeks.
And that was at what age now, do you think?
I was like 20, yeah.
So it healed right away.
Yeah, I'm sure it did. I don't even remember. I remember like squatting down, like, ooh, the side of my knee hurts. Is that bad?
How do you deal with injuries now compared to then?
I definitely baby them a lot more now, for sure. Like, I take them more serious. But I feel like my injuries now are just way worse than they were. like I think recently, like my most recent knee injury was I was going for a twister hook and the guy kicked his leg out and my knee just popped. And I was like, I was not expecting that to happen whatsoever. Another knee injury I had, I was rolling with Greg and I was just doing a regular knee cut. And then he tried to go to deep half guard at the same time. And for whatever reason, my MCL, like, you know, I got a sprain, like a slight tear. And I was like, why did my knee just like break for no reason?
Yeah, you're old.
Yes.
All right, I don't want to divert the topic too much. Let's go back to first competition.
Yeah, and then the finals, I lost by triangle, even though I was winning. But the funny thing is, I think I had trained at Henzo's the week before. And I met like Magno. I think Magno was like coaching me during that match just because he met me one time. And I thought that was really cool. Like, that was really cool because no one else had known I was going. Like,
just team loyalty, baby.
Yeah. All of a sudden, like, I think I was wearing like a Henzo shirt too. So a lot of people were come around and it was good to be part of that like team. And all of a sudden by that last match, all of a sudden I had like a whole group of guys from Henzo's. I think Rodrigo was there too. And he's like, you got this,
this
man.
Kid's a winner.
And I was winning on a huge points margin. And I got triangled doing really silly stuff because twice during that tournament, I remember getting caught in a kind of a triangle. I would almost bait a triangle and I would duck my head to the outside and do like a quick pass. And I'd gotten that to work once or twice in training. So that's kind of like why I would use it. And it worked in a tournament. So I just thought, well, this is
proof of concept.
Yeah, exactly. It's going to work every time. And it worked early in the match. And that's how I passed a guy's guard. I was up by like 10 points or something like that, or 11 points. And then the guy recovered guard. And I probably should have just stayed in his guard for the last 2 minutes of the match. Instead, I was like baiting a triangle again.
And you were trying to please the crowd. You wanted to finish. All these Henzo guys. Imagine how crazy it would have went if you would have submitted them.
I know.
You were thinking that. I know.
Definitely.
First tournament, first place.
And then I got put in a triangle, and then the guy was, like, a lot taller than me, too. And he just, like, locked it up, and I was like, wait, I can't slip my head out. And then I was like, well, I'm not getting out of this. And
do you wish you had yourself now coaching back then? You know how to get out of that triangle now.
I know. If only.
Specifically, he had a period where you were just like, all right, this is the triangle defense. And you're like, nobody can triangle me now.
Yeah, well, absolutely. Anytime I get excited about a technique, I just put myself in that position over and over.
All right, so now let's skip a little bit ahead here. You're a blue belt a long time. You're training mostly here, right? In this school?
Yeah, and also then Jamie started teaching in Bergenfield.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
So then George opened up around, what year was that he opened?
That was like 2005.
So Dave pretty much trained with him almost from the start.
I started in 2006.
Yep. Yeah, I believe it was 2005, maybe like fall of 2004. But then we probably didn't really have any
real
students.
So when did you start teaching there?
Oh, right from the beginning.
Right from the start. You're there, you're teaching just like once a week, or you were teaching more classes than that?
You know what? I actually was doing more of the kickboxing program.
Oh, right. Okay.
Yeah, so I was doing the kickboxing program. I was going to train most nights at where Jamie was teaching, and Bergenfield.
Were you teaching here at all? Like Taekwondo?
Yes. I think I was teaching a little bit, yeah.
So you just bouncing around?
I was
martial arts full time.
I was going all over the place. And then I remember when George wanted to open the school, he actually asked me, was telling me about it first, before he was like, yeah, I want to get back into it, because he got out of the business for a while, And then he was starting to train again hard. I noticed that he's starting training like all the time. I was like, oh, okay, it's good to see him training again. He was coming up by Jamie's, he was going to Henzo's. And then he decided to open up, and I was like, oh, okay, cool. Then I was like, I kind of thought, I was excited about that, because if I got to teach a class, which was my Friday class, which didn't happen, I don't think, right away. I think I started teaching like kids, and like, I was excited to teach because I had never taught jiu-jitsu before, and I already loved jiu-jitsu a lot, And I had.
Would you like pull guys aside that were like white belts when you were a blue belt and just be like,
give them tips? Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. I would always be sharing stuff that anytime I would be excited about technique, I would make sure I would share it with someone and be like, yo, check this out. This is how I escaped this move, or this is the guard I saw Marcelo do, or something like that. And then when I started teaching, of course, that's when I got to actually work with people, in a structured class. I was already experienced teaching from Taekwondo, so I knew how to structure a class. So I was excited to basically share my knowledge.
Now, I remember the first time I met you that I can remember was a Sunday open mat. You remember those Sunday open mats?
Oh, absolutely.
No gi, everyone would just show up, no warm up, and we would just try and kill each other from the beginning.
Gi pants and a t-shirt.
I remember walking in and you and George were rolling, and it was just like a whirlwind of technique, and I just was in awe when I saw you two guys rolling. And then I remember from the get-go, you, just like Ed had asked if you were correcting, from the very beginning, when I first met you, before I even knew you were coaching there yet, you had already started giving me little pointers. Back then, 2006. I guess I haven't listened to them all, but... So, yeah, that was the first time that I met you. And then shortly after that is when I started to try and incorporate your Friday night classes, which is really that just
embedded
in me.
Did you feel a difference in the community? Like, did you feel the growth around then, like 2005, 6, 7, like when UFC came out on TV, prime time?
Definitely when Ultimate Fighter came out. That's I think, a big turning point when all of a sudden I realized, oh, there's going to be jiu-jitsu all the time. We're going to like have influx of people, I remember I was teaching at that time, and you just saw like the class sizes just grew. And it got me really excited, because I was like, nothing I want to do more than just train every day. And
what about like instructional stuff? Like those were starting to come out a little more around then?
Or like, oh, yeah.
Easier to get hold of like Marcelo, like 2003, or wasn't the Abu Dhabi here once?
2007. We all went together.
2007, Abu Dhabi was here. In 2005, Abu Dhabi was in California. I think like right before the 2007 Abu Dhabi was when I started really... Oh, actually, no, that's not true. Because actually, I remember going on like a forum, like MMA.TV. They were talking about Abu Dhabi in Brazil in 2003. And then someone had uploaded like a couple of matches.
That's probably where you were hearing about Eddie Bravo for the first time.
Yeah, I was aware of Eddie Bravo, and he was one of the guys on the mat I would watch. He was the first guy I ever saw do a half guard, his old school sweep.
What year was that?
This is 2003, 2002.
Wow, is that when you started, like, all right, half guard?
You know what? I was aware. Jamie used to teach half guard as well before that, so I liked half guard, but when I saw Eddie Bravo using all his matches, I'd be like, all right, well, this is a nice, easy way to get on top. And so I was a fan of Eddie Bravo at that time. And then everyone was like stoked on Eddie Bravo that year. But the first match I had watched from ADCC 2003 was Marcelo Garcia versus Shaolin. I didn't know who Marcelo Garcia was, but I had heard of Shaolin. I was aware that he was very good. He was fighting in Japan at the time, MMA. So I was like, ooh, cool, I got to see Shaolin's match. I want to see Shaolin.
Surprise.
And when I had watched that, I was like, he just squeezed his head. It was lucky. And then he got choked out with it. It was like, that had to be luck. And then after it was all said and done, someone made a highlight of Marcelo. And I was like, oh no, this guy's amazing.
Yeah, that was his first year winning Abu Dhabi, right?
Yeah, first year. I think he might have still been a brown belt or maybe just got his black belt.
I think it was like a week before he got his black belt. I think he was just talking about it on another podcast.
Yeah, and I know that he wasn't even supposed to do Abu Dhabi because he had lost in the finals of the trials.
Yes.
And then someone got injured and he became a last minute replacement.
Wow.
And his first match was against Henzo. And he like beat Henzo like 12-0 or something, took his back. And then every other match he submitted the guy. And he was using like arm drags really, really well. And I was like, this is amazing, using arm drag. And then he would jump on the back. He would use the seatbelt control, which I don't know if I was aware of the seatbelt control. It's kind of funny that's like something to even use. But like, I remember watching that and just thinking, oh, if I just keep over and under, I can keep someone's back way better, and you're always right there ready to choke. And I was excited to like...
Wait, how many years in jiu-jitsu were you learning that?
Probably a couple of years, you
think
know?
Think about the Donaher stuff you're showing now.
I know.
Compared to you figuring out that a seatbelt grip is the right grip.
I mean, we're talking about Windows 3.1 versus like, you know, all the newest computers you have now, you know?
Crazy. All right.
iPhones versus...
So my first week, I can remember my first week pretty much crystal clear. I'm coming. I watched The Ultimate Fighter. I'm like, I'm going to be a killer. I'm going to go around and beat dudes up. So first class was 2-stripe and under, white belt. And it was just a basic class, very structured, very martial arts, like Taekwondo, like a lot of warm-ups. Then we did the drills. No rolling. We just learned a couple techniques. Maybe we did like live from the back for like 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Right? So then the next day I go to kickboxing. I want to beat Chuck Liddell. Wednesday, same thing as Monday. Thursday, I'm like, all right, this is my routine now. I'm going to be a machine. Then I come to your class, Friday. No-gi, my first no-gi class. Got my board shorts. I'm ready to step in the octagon.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
No, but this is my first class with advanced people. The first two classes, you know, there's some upper belts that, you know, hang out because the advanced class is right after.
Right after.
But mostly, I'm working with brand new people because they're my friends. I come to your class, and you're like, all right, no warm-ups.
Yeah.
What do you guys want to work on today? I'm like, what is this? It's pretty much the same way you are now. Because it's not even your school, so you're not like super, you know, trying to keep everybody in line. It's just like, yeah, you guys show up. Let's work on some moves that you think about, and then we'll do King of the Mat. So I remember my first day, we learned scissor sweep from closed guard. Very simple stuff. And then I remember jumping into the King of the Mat. There's probably 12, 15 people on the mat. Mostly white belt and blue belts. And just getting flipped over and over. Butterfly swept. Watch these guys get butterfly swept. I'm like, what's going on? Is this the unbeatable move? And now this is the move I still do to this day. Just because that your first class being there.
That's still my favorite guard that I learned from Yanni back then, 2006, 2007.
Yeah, I mean, I got that from Jamie. Even that style of teaching was kind of the way Jamie would teach here. Like when we had this program here, like George taught a few classes and Jamie taught on Monday, he taught a no-gi class. And Jamie definitely taught it in a very like laid back. He would always ask what we would want to do. And then we would go over a technique and then we would just, but it was pretty laid back like that as well. And I really like that style.
It's so like a mix of a private and a seminar, but just for like a regular jiu-jitsu class.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
Exactly. And from what I understand, that's kind of way Donner teaches his classes as well. He doesn't have a warm up. He expects everyone to warm up on their own. He doesn't necessarily ask. I think he's got his own curriculum in his head.
It's like Navy SEAL training. Navy SEALs, they expect you to be in shape. Like, you get in shape on your own. When you come here, it's time to work.
Exactly.
But, so around this time, 2007, that's when I'm talking about, you're getting ready to start the jiu-jitsu here or take over this school, right?
Right.
When was that? Like,
yeah, I guess that's 2007.
Like, it had to be closer to the end because I remember looking for schools in the middle of 2007, and I don't know if yours popped up or maybe you didn't have your Google AdWords right, but I found George's.
Right. So I think I was already open, but I might not have had like a real jiu-jitsu program yet. You know, when I first took over this gym, it was still Taekwondo, and I was trying to start a jiu-jitsu program. Probably only had like one student, maybe Jeff. But it took like a little while before it was really like, I think 2008's like when we had like people on the mat actually training.
Well, that's when I started jiu-jitsu here. So I did my year over there, took plenty of breaks. So I signed up for a year, probably trained
from the beginning.
Probably trained about 6 months of that year.
Yeah.
But what happened was Corey would come over here to, he was getting ready for some tournament. So he's like, oh, I'm training at Yanni's to get a little extra, you know? I was like, all right. So then when my year was up, I took another break. I'm like, I don't know. But then I got the itch again. And I'm like, where should I go back to Georgia's, or let's see what Yanni's got going over there.
I know. I remember when you showed up, I was in shock. I was kind of wondering, you know, you shouldn't be coming here. You're a Georgia student. I was definitely like nervous about it. I actually ended up talking to George about it, and he was happy to.
Didn't you say you thought it was a different person though when you?
Yeah, he thought you were
Eddie Messick. I went to high school with him, and he trained, and we started around the same time. And he thought he was talking about him. He's like, "Oh, you could have him."
Yeah, so he would have been him. Upset if it was you. You think?
I don't think so either. No, I wasn't good back then.
No, I don't think he would have missed you one bit.
He wouldn't have cared.
He probably didn't know. Probably didn't even know your name.
You don't get a name until blue belt. That's the rules.
That's the old rule. That's something that classic Brian decided. You know, a long time ago.
That's our rule here.
You don't get a name.
No, we don't call you by your name until you get a blue belt.
Nameless white belt.
You don't deserve a name.
That's not how it was when I started. When I started, there were only like 5 or 6 people in class.
No, that's how it was for us too, though. Yeah. We just recently made that. Once everybody goes up, you want
to. Oh, now that's a new rule. Okay.
Yeah, once you're no longer a white belt, you make that rule.
Then you can get an A.
But 2008, you know, it's all white belts on the map.
Yeah.
Everybody's a white belt. You had like 7, 8 guys. What did you think about that? It was like back to square one for you, kind of. Like you would still go and train with Jamie, but
what
was it like cultivating from zero? Like in this environment where it's still not mainstream yet. Like 2007, 2008,
not
2009,
at all.
It wasn't mainstream yet. So you're still trying to cultivate this niche kind of business.
Yeah, I was definitely excited about it because I was big on sharing my techniques with everyone anyway. So I knew that if I did a good job, everyone would get good fast. So I would just do my best to make sure everyone would get good enough to like start pushing me in roles as well. But
it was rough for you then. You're not getting any good roles in here, basically, for the first 3-4 years.
Unless people visited, like, you know, guys from Jamie would come and visit and stuff like that.
Well, you were still with George at that point, too, still teaching on Friday nights, right?
Yes, exactly. I would go there
on
Fridays.
Because you only had a couple classes. You had Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, and then an open mat on Sunday.
Exactly. So absolutely, I would go there. I think in the beginning, I would even try to get any of my students to come on Fridays up to Denville. You know, I think every once in a while they would come and visit.
We used to, like, I used to go to Denville, but then we used to do that together. We used to go roll with Pat Sullivan. He gave me my cauliflower ear.
Yeah, absolutely.
It was still fun to roll with those guys. There still wasn't that many schools yet. Now, it's crazy.
Now
there's schools everywhere, which is great for jiu-jitsu. We want it to get bigger and bigger.
Yeah, I think it's a product of just people who stuck around, you know. If you stick around 10 years later, all of a sudden, all these guys that were white belts are now black belts, and then they're ready to open their school or whatever, you know. And it's pretty cool to see that. Of course, everyone gets nervous. It's like, oh, now everyone's going to leave my school for whatever, for the new school opening up. But I try not to think about that.
Well, Dave had a question that he wanted to ask about promotions.
I don't remember it now.
Now he doesn't remember, but good thing I remember because I remember.
Good, thank you.
This is Dave's question. What was...
Oh, I remember.
Go ahead.
What was it like when you had another school in the area that maybe shut down and now you have an influx into your school?
You're skipping ahead.
Okay, go ahead then.
I forgot about the...
Go ahead, you ask it. Go ahead, do it. This is what happens with me and Ed. Ed was yelling at me, don't ask your questions.
He's screaming into the microphone.
This is a new microphone, I'm not used to it.
All right, this is the question that he asked me in the car. You got your black belt in 2010.
This is a great
question. How many blue belts from 2007 when you started your program to 2010 before you got your black belt? How many blue belts did you have?
I just had one.
Just one. But did you promote them?
I had Jamie teach a seminar and Jamie promoted for sure.
So his question, go ahead.
Now, my question is, when you got your black belt, what was more rewarding to you? Receiving your black belt or awarding your first promotions directly from you?
I would definitely put promoting people ahead of getting promoted.
That's what I said, Dave.
No,
I said that exactly.
He said getting your black belt was more important. And I said, no, not Yanni. I'm telling you, Yanni was much happier promoting.
He's taking the words.
Promoting.
I said those words to him, and he's taking them.
And you pretend to know him. H, I don't know why you're siding with this guy. I know you better.
There's no way you know me better. There's no way. Oh, you know him better.
Then how did you not know the answer to this question?
I knew the answer to that. You're taking...
Oh, my God.
No, I'll be honest, like I didn't even, at that day, like I was very excited to have my blue belt, and me getting my black belt that day was shocking. Honestly, I didn't feel I was ready for my black belt, so I was like, oh man, I
remember because when you started here, like you opened your, you were 4 straight purple, right?
Yeah.
And then I remember when I came 2008, you got your brown belt. Mm-hmm. Right? And then so 2 years at brown belt, yeah, you're probably thinking like, oh, I was a blue belt for 7 years, I'll probably be a brown belt.
Yeah, exactly.
Were you, did you ever feel ready for any of your promotions, and what was your favorite promotion?
I would say there's only one promotion I feel like I was actually ready for, and that was my purple belt, just because I was a blue belt for so long. And like at that time, even when they would be visiting guys from like Henzo's or whatever in class, or I think at that time AMA had just opened up and it was the MMA program was starting up. I would train with blue belts, and I would almost like see another strange blue belt and be like, okay, this should be a fairly good role for me, you know? And then a purple belt would come in, I would roll and I'd be like, okay, let's see how I match up. And I would roll well with the purple belts, you know? So I knew I was ready for purple belt, but I knew like I wanted to get a few wins at blue belt because I wasn't competing that often. I think I had like won one tournament at blue belt that time, and I think I did like Battle of the Beach. I took second, which I came so close to winning, and I really wanted that to be like my blue belt
just
win.
Just the exclamation point on the blue belt career.
And then shortly after, I got my purple belt, you know?
So how did things change for you from being a school owner? Because before you owned the school, you know, it's pretty lax for you. I just train as much as I can.
Yeah.
My focus is on me. I got to get better, I can help guys, you know, casually, but it's the focus is on my game. How did that transfer when you really, like when you got your black belt, did it change?
Well, basically once I started teaching, my focus was on my students for sure. I would always think to myself, like I would rather be known for having amazing students than me being amazing. You know what I mean?
That's... Absolutely. We had this conversation the other day, I'd remember. We would rather be a better coach than a better competitor ourselves.
Well, that's because we're losers, me and you specifically.
Well, I'm old. You still have time. I don't know what your problem is. So
I've already
unmotivated.
Transferred over to, let me just help somebody. I just want to help somebody.
Yeah. Well, for sure. I would, once I started teaching, I would just be like, I would always use that as proof that my technique would work, that if my students were good, you know? And I, of course, that's why if I would have a girl in class, I would make sure that the girl would be very good too. Because that's a good proof for a new student that if a girl can beat you, or like a young teenage boy that's like way smaller than everyone in class is able to beat you, then the technique is good.
100%. I remember one, very beginning of my jiu-jitsu career, or whatever you want to call it, June. Do you remember June?
Absolutely.
Little girl, and she would beat me up. And then that's when I knew this was for real.
Yeah. It's always impressive to see a girl that was good. It also shows, you know, gives validity to the instructor, you know.
It was a little more savage back then, you got to admit. Like, for a girl to roll back then,
I know.
It's dangerous.
That's the thing. It was very rare for a girl to do that. So the personality of a girl to want to come in, even though she's only training with guys, it must have been tough, you know?
Well, that also, like, if there's a little less technique, the technique was lacking compared to today.
Yeah.
They got to make up for it somehow. How do you do it? Brute force, like speed, power,
exactly.
Right?
Yeah, it's a tough situation for them because they may, especially if they're like, oh, I'm trying to do the moves, and it's easy to get frustrated.
Oh, it's easy to get frustrated if you're a big guy.
I know.
Just easy. In general, jiu-jitsu is very frustrating.
I know. You could do a move 90% right. The
and
other
not.
Guy...
Finish.
Is doing their move 91% right, and all of a sudden, it's, you know, it's zero sum. One person wins, the other person
or
loses.
Maybe I'm just so much stronger than Dave, he'll never break any of my grips.
No, listen, he just put the nail on the head, hit the nail on the head. You are only 1% better,
that's
but
not
it's
even,
just enough
that's
to
not what he
by.
Said. That's not what he said
he
at all.
He just said 91% versus 90%.
Yeah, let me just paint
he
you
was
picture.
Using us as an example.
When I roll with Dave, right, we roll in the gi because gentlemen roll in the gi, savages roll in the gi. When I make a grip on his collar, I feel terrible if I hold on to it when he tries to break it.
But he does hold on to it. Let's make sure we all know.
What I do is I'll grab, he'll try to break it, I will hold it for 1 second just to let him know that if I wanted to, this is my grip.
This is your path.
And then I'll let go and let him try to do whatever he's going to do.
It doesn't make sense to me how strong you are sometimes. You are 230 pounds.
207.8.
All right. One day I challenged him and I'm like, there's no way you could do one wide grip pull-up. Look at him.
Oh.
Totally out of shape. Goes over, grabs the pull-up bar on the wide grip and just starts cranking them out. And I...
Dude,
could
you don't
imagine
know.
If he was in shape at 230 pounds just cranking out wide grip
Dude,
pull-ups?
We've worked
Come
out
on.
Together, man, at Gary's, and we do these workouts. And I remember one workout we did where we were doing dips, and Ed was beasting those dips.
I don't understand it, though. He shouldn't be able to do that at this size.
Listen, right after those pull-ups, I had to lay down for a little bit. It's not like I'm ripping pull-ups out and then doing jumping jacks after.
Went home and refueled with ice cream.
But I was arguing, Dave, that like my technique actually gets better because I spend most of my rolls at empty. So it's only technique. I can't use any of my strength after that.
Certain techniques, so you have to understand that when you're not moving as much, you have to rely on like tactics.
Oh, I don't have any... Would you call my game dynamic?
No, absolutely not.
Those are the things that fall by the wayside when you are completely out of shape.
Sometimes I see Ed stepping up and then I'm like, no, Ed, you gotta be more smooth and relaxed.
Loose, yeah.
Would you say that that's the number one mistake with people is stiffening up?
No, different people have different stuff, right?
I feel like that's the thing I hear the most from
Yanni. It's me and you. That's what me and you do the most. We're stiff. We're like plywood rolling.
I'm fluid, like water.
No.
Like water.
It's hard to be loose, of course, but I think people that stiffen up are usually just overthinking the situation and they freeze up. It's like a deer in the headlights.
That's true.
I never do that.
They're like someone's grabbing it. Like let's just say, especially like if sometimes you'll see like, let's say a smaller person in a bigger person's guard, right? The bigger person gets in some sort of offensive grip like collar and sleeve. All of a sudden the little person just like stiffens up and doesn't try to pass and all of a sudden they just get knocked over or they accept the guard where in reality they should be a little bit looser, break the grip, and have confidence in their game, you know?
He's talking to you, Dave.
No, he was looking at you, Ed. Eye contact is important when you're having a conversation.
I'm the big guy in the bottom that's freezing up when I have my good grips. That's me. I'm freezing.
You're getting good grips and freezing up.
Yeah, and then the guy on top is like, all right, let me just walk around, and then they pass.
Have no fear of his grips.
All right,
let's go
to the boom, though. We're getting close to the boom. Like 2010, you get your black belt. And now, right around when you got the new mats, like, what was it, end of 2011?
Yeah.
I felt like another level. We leveled up again in the jiu-jitsu world. It's starting to become more mainstream. UFC's getting out of control, popular.
Yeah. Well, I mean, shortly after that's when we had, I think, the Mendez Bros. Maybe it was a year, maybe a little bit.
I think that was 2012.
It was 2012. It was right before I got my purple belt. It was like in the summer of 2012. Guy Mendez came. Blew our minds.
Yeah, absolutely. And I really feel that that was the beginning of a more modern era.
Can we just say that we showed him the clap? Like, he got the clap at the end of the moves from us.
He got the clap.
Where did we get it from?
I got it.
Not an STD, everyone.
I got it from watching. Actually, it was Mike Fowler teaching like at Lloyd Irvin's or something like that. I don't know how I saw the video. It was like, I think he just showed like a warm up. And then he's like, everyone got it? All right, one, two, three. And then they clap and everyone
went. It's like an exclamation point or it's like a period at the end of a sentence.
Yeah.
It's weird.
I know. When I saw that, I was like, oh, that's cool. Because it kind of reminded me of like, that's probably like you're in football or something like that.
It's the break of the huddle.
It's just a cue. It's a cue for you to do what you're supposed to. Instead, if you don't have it, it's like, okay. And then people kind of meander for a second.
Yeah. I would definitely always teach a move. And I'd be like, does everyone have any questions? And everyone's like, half of them probably weren't paying attention when I taught it anyway. And then I'm like, do you guys want to do the move? Or then, but then once we start doing that, it's like, all right, that means we go.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
And then I remember after Guy would showed his first move, I was like, everyone got that? And I made everyone clap. And then when Guy taught the second move, he kind of looked around with a big smile on his face, opened his hand, and he's like, and I was like, that's kind of cool. And then, of course, everyone pretty much uses it now.
So then you taught Guy as much as he taught you, huh?
Probably. I don't know if he was doing that before, but I feel that we showed it to him.
Yanni, I cannot wait. Until we gotta video this as soon as possible.
We're gonna video it.
We gotta get
one of
those.
Guy in the car. We'll do it right now.
No, no. We need at least two people video camering.
Yeah,
we need your two extra refs because you're a big baby about it.
Yeah, he's not going to be.
He's going to be biased.
No, he's going to be biased.
He's not going to be biased.
He's going to be biased because he's going to be seeing you getting smashed.
Would you rather him ref or coach me? There you go.
Man.
So you can have one of them.
Why couldn't he coach me?
Wait,
would you rather ref or coach me?
How about I commentate for the live stream?
Oh, no, we're going to do both.
We have a whole other thing set up for this. Yeah.
Oh.
This is going to be multiple use content.
Yeah.
The original content, people will just see.
Me
the smashing.
Destroy.
No, he'll see the smashing. And then afterwards, we'll have a smashing breakdown.
A smashing breakdown.
Co-commentated by all three of us.
Oh, that would be great. Yeah.
Smash breakdown. You can point out all the things that we did wrong.
Which will be many.
or right.
I'm sure.
Which will be much less.
I'm like, what did we do right? Well, that part, that video is going to be very short.
You made a very good grip right here.
But Yanni, what if I beat him in 50 seconds? Should we just go again?
That's a good question. That's two out of three.
What is it, round robin? Best out of three.
I'll do best out of 20. I'll win all 20.
You're not going to win all
20. Maybe we should just do 20 minutes of rolling.
Oh, that'd be phenomenal.
I don't like that.
Number of wins. Number person with most wins.
I actually
wait, how do you win,
that.
Though? Because I haven't submitted Ed in 10 years.
No. Well, yeah, how would you win that? That would be a good point. Like, say
it's
you do,
just we score up points that whole
time? Yeah, I couldn't be 20 minutes. That's crazy.
That's great for me.
10 minutes straight of rolling. Just like a regular roll. 10-minute roll, and taps have to be a certain amount of points. Along with points. So you do points plus tap. A tap's got to be worth like 10
points
or something.
Jeez, it's got to be worth like 10 points. Yeah, that makes sense.
And then points are worth
points regular are worth points. Points. And we have advantages. There'll be like 100 advantages.
Wait a second. This is an all so new you rule can, set. Are you proposing a new rule set right now?
Let's bring this up right now. This rule has to be implemented today in IBJJF. If you have a seatbelt grip from the back, each hook should cost 2 points. You get 2 points per hook. Because you are in a super...
So
you can finish with one hook. You can finish with one hook.
So then you want 2 points for one hook. That's actually
a good
idea.
Can we make that our own rule?
That's I like that.
Ed's been talking about this for years.
I don't know who to tell this to. How do I get this through? This
right now, you're telling the people. One hook, 2 points.
But you have to have seatbelt control, chest to back.
What if you have one hook, but you're kind of falling off of them and you have a seatbelt?
Chest to back.
Yeah.
You can tell when somebody's got good. If their back is on the mat, it's not a hook.
Like, I could see if your knee is next to their far hip. Like, you have one hook and the other knee next to the hip.
Right. Okay. Oh, yeah. Hip. It's got to be chest to chest, like
because,
hip to hip.
I know, because that's the tricky part.
Shouldn't it be some kind of points for crucifix? That's like such a dominant position.
It should be points
position.
For crucifix. There are
something.
Plenty of positions where you don't get
is
points.
Is crucifix
in IBJJF.
An advantage?
No, you don't get anything unless you're threatening a submission.
Our rules... Crucifix is an advantage.
Oh, now you're in
if
trouble.
You trap
that's
the
your
arm, if you trap,
position.
If you trap the arm...
You might, unless they count that as a near back take, I don't know if they do.
If you trap the arm with the proper leg... Either
which
leg,
one's the proper
leg?
Leg?
No, either leg,
leg yes.
Because you could do... Mono, what is it? Reverse
omoplata.
Yeah, so either leg and what kind of grip. Mm. It's got to be like their back on your chest with some kind of control of the arms, both arms. We'll make our own rules. They don't know what they're doing.
But you're saying should you get points for a crucifix?
Not points, maybe an advantage.
No, why just not points?
I don't
why
know.
Not 2 points.
One
three
point.
Points.
Let's start. Yanni, we make our own rules. We'll start adding 1 point for stuff.
Yeah, let's 1 point for crucifix.
That's 1 point. Collar grip. That's one
actually,
point.
Actually, I would accept 1 point for crucifix. Crucifix is really good, but it could easily end up with you on bottom.
Not what you just showed
control.
Us. You just showed us the control.
I know,
they
but
should
I
never be...
fixed every detail.
I also showed how it can go wrong. So
push the elbow.
Yeah, so. That's why it's such a dynamic.
Oh, just because you can defend it, then triangles shouldn't even count anymore because they don't happen.
Well, they don't give you points for triangles. So.
I know, but they give you an advantage for almost getting a triangle.
So now, based off this theory, do you get points for a Kimura trap?
That's a good question. I think you should.
No, we're getting
it's too easy
now.
To get a Kimura trap.
So then, why wouldn't you get points for single X?
Why would you get points for that?
By your
about?
Logic, why
no.
not?
What are you talking
Nogi,
about?
Nogi, single X. No. You're very close to a leg lock.
It's ridiculous. Don't be ridiculous.
That's what I'm talking about.
No, that's ridiculous.
Only place you get points is crucifix. That's a very dominant position.
But what about the two hooks?
I like that. Actually, I like that. Ed and I agreed on something.
I suppose when we're talking about crucifix, I guess if you have the person in a full-on crucifix.
Arms isolated.
And you're holding it for 3 seconds.
It should
seconds.
Be like Neon Belly. Yeah. Yeah, something like that.
So I'd like to bring you teaching back up, H. So... You in the area are known to be a great instructor. What do you think, like, what do you do off the mat to ensure that you're giving your students the best?
Well, I tried my best to set like a weekly curriculum, you know. Every time I teach a class, well, actually, for a while, before I was a little bit more organized, every time I would teach a class, I would try to, like, kind of document what I taught that day or something like that. Maybe write down like, all right, this was a half guard class and I taught getting to the knees, taking the back, you know. And I would just make sure that I would have like a system in place so that next time I taught it, I would teach it the same way, teach it a little bit better.
What about all this new school stuff though? Like stuff that you haven't seen before, like the lapel guard, you're not super into it yet. Like it has, like I feel like it's gonna, like one day you're just gonna do it like you did with the leg locks. Like, all right, I'm gonna learn this, I'm gonna be the best at it. Like, how do you get into something like that?
Well, you just start trying it. And a lot. Usually it starts by, you know, drilling it a little bit, maybe during open mat, and then rolling. And then you got to do a lot of trial and error, you know, and train with
different
people.
Do you do like a lot of watching, like videos, DVDs?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Like, that's what... I definitely try to. I definitely try to watch instructionals, you know, usually the best names.
Do you set yourself up with a time? Like, do you have a schedule of, on Mondays I study instructionals, on Tuesday I'm prepping my email?
I can answer this. No way. Yeah. Yanni just watches.
I do not. I will watch leisurely, and then usually what happens, if I really like something, I will probably spend the next few days really watching it over and over to make sure I understand
okay.
it.
Okay.
Yeah, he wants me to be happy. Overall, yeah. right? Isn't your number one thing?
Happy
want me to
equals
be happy?
Fat for of course, you, all right? I don't want you fat. I want you thin. I want you dominant.
Nobody
and
cares.
Let's get at
Nobody
it.
Cares what Dave wants. Let's just get that straight.
I care. I'm the only one that matters.
That's why you're a loser. You gotta care about everybody else.
No. Everybody's going to be happier when you're thin.
Who?
Everyone.
People love me when I'm fat.
H, he's thin. He's motivated. He's coming to class. You happy about that?
Hold on.
I just want Ed to be here. That's the main thing. It's like...
You don't care. He could just show up and be the fat, disgusting slob that he
Wait,
is.
So well, saying, I think if he's showing up on a regular basis, like...
It's just, yeah, it'll fix itself.
It'll fix itself.
No, but he has trained very consistently and not lost a pound.
No, I take intermittent fasting. I mean, intermittent breaks. That's what I do. Like, I can't be coming to class all day, every day. You gotta give me a month or two in between.
And you think that works for you?
No,
just like intermittent fasting
this
works
is
for
why
some people.
You saw the post I put, Brown Belt for Life. It's real. Yeah. It's a real thing.
That was awesome. Like, that was very good.
That was good. I actually really loved the thought bubbles.
I love
the speech bubbles.
That was
fun.
Very funny. I was wishing that I'd had all your Photoshop experience that you've just been learning.
Did you see Gary's comment?
Yeah, I saw what he said.
It really looks like I'm saying yeah.
No, but this is one of the things where, like, for you as a teacher promoting, all right, mm-hmm. how many black belts have you promoted?
Well, I haven't really promoted anyone here at Up Top. You know, I promoted like Andy and Mikey, you know.
Oh, you gave them, I wasn't there for that. You gave them their belts?
I wrapped it around their waist, That's you know. Cool. I think I was the one who like promoted. Of course, I was in a second degree at the time. So I think Jamie was who they're actually under. You
but
know?
How many years have you been teaching?
Long time, I guess since 2000, whatever.
So we're saying like a typical black belt takes about 10 years. You've been training people about 13 years.
I know.
And how many you got...
I don't have any.
Who's going to be your first black belt, do you think?
I was thinking it was going to be Joe.
I think it's going to be Dwayne.
Yeah, probably be Dwayne.
Probably Dwayne. Dwayne's the closest.
Now, how long do you think it will be before Ed receives a black belt?
That is 100% on Ed, I think.
See? He's not just going to give it out to me.
He
just wants his...
I wanted a guess. I wanted a number. Training the way that he currently trains, how long do you think? 6 more years?
Oh, well... Training, you mean as in training for a month and then not training?
Yeah, exactly. Or will you not even give it to him?
He would never
give it
to him.
I don't know if he would ever get a black belt at that rate.
Not for him, no way. So Dave's phenomenal. No, the reason Dave's asking is very selfishly. Because he can see on the horizon that his teacher is going to come and he's going to wrap the black around his waist and then he's going to be rolling with me in class and then people are going to be coming in, brand new students, and they're going to be like, what's going on here?
I won't allow Ed to come anymore, and I'll stop cross-training.
Yanni would love that. Yanni, where would you rather me train, here or Dave's?
Oh, of course I want you here.
What? Don't you care about me at all?
I care about you, but everyone misses Ed.
No one misses me?
Nobody even knows who you are.
He just spit his water out.
And you are?
I'm the entertainment. I come for people to beat on.
Dave, you need to come more often for sure.
I do need to come more often. Yeah, it was Fridays, and then it just, like, always does. Life gets in the way, and I don't get to come here on Fridays.
Yeah,
but it's because I'm on the mat the rest of the week.
Yeah,
sometimes I have to designate some time for the family. But only sometime, Ed, not every day of the week for months on end.
My family really loves me.
I believe that. I don't know how, but I believe it.
What are you talking about? Yanni just said all the people here miss me. You know, Yanni, this has been happening a lot to me recently, and it really hurts my feelings. People... think that I'm 40.
Oh, no.
What's the problem? What, do I look 40?
Yes.
I think you're just like very grumpy. You have the
grumpiness as
old
age?
People associate grumpiness with old age.
You think I'm grumpy?
A little bit.
Come on.
I think you just look horrible. That's the reason that you look 40.
I think sometimes when you walk in, you like shake your head looking at the floor. And everyone's like, is Ed mad at me or something?
I guess maybe that's a little true. Just when I get here, but then once I'm in it...
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. I'm fun.
Yeah.
Ugh.
Yeah, but you disappear without even saying goodbye.
It hurts because...
Although there are a lot of people that sometimes I'm like, I don't think Ed likes me just because he doesn't talk to you or something.
I hear that all the time.
Well, they're probably right.
They're probably right. That's
people say that to me all the time.
They're like, wait, do you just run around passing the guard, or do you use pressure passing? Yeah, Ed doesn't like you.
Remember when I got mad at what's his name here? He was we were doing King of the Mat.
Oh, Dan, right?
Yeah, Dan.
He kept getting up to wrestle him.
His purple belt. He started training here how long has it been? It's been a couple of years, right?
Yeah, about a year and a half ago, probably.
It was probably like a year ago. We're doing King of the Mat. He's down, I'm up. And he starts trying to stand up and wrestle with me. He's not playing the game. So I put him on his back and I started scolding him because I don't like that kind of stuff.
Everybody plays a different game. There are a lot of people that I've trained with that stand up.
What is
rather
the point
the
of
game?
King of the Mat? Is it for you to learn how to sweep or learn how to stand up?
Oh, yeah, you got to work on
your guard. We're trying to learn. Are we in a competition right now? Like, I'm giving you a little space. You're going to stand up, and then what, you win the round?
Yeah, no, if you're looking for a way out, that's frustrating because you shouldn't just get up to take the person down. But if the person on top has to also do their job of keeping
them
down.
Holding you down, so. Yeah. I like when people stand up because it gives you something else to work on. Like if you train with an MMA guy, no-gi, Ed, mostly no-gi.
This is why you're a loser. You're going to let people in your school cheat rather than
put
them in their place.
Nobody at my school does it, but there are people
that do it. I think if you stand
it.
Up, it should just be a reset, though. It shouldn't be like a win for the bottom person because that's some places they do it that way, that if you bottom person just gets up, it's a win. And what ends up happening is you start seeing a lot of explosive kicks. Like you kick the person away and they just get up and it's like, okay, but what happens when you can't do that to someone, you know? What happens if you do that to
That's
a bigger person?
That's what I'm saying. Don't let him cheat. You're helping everybody. I'm helping him by yelling at him.
Now let people know, how excited are you for this challenge match and commentating on it?
I'm
later.
Very excited. It's going to be amazing.
I don't even know why Dave's smiling right now. He's the butt of the joke.
No.
You are the donkey.
When I win this challenge match, how are you going to feel, Ed?
Do you want to make stakes on this? You really don't want to do this. Do you want to make stakes?
How are you going to feel?
I'm going to be excited. Win or lose, I don't care who wins, but I love Dave's confidence, though.
I've been training with him. I know what he's capable of and his shortcomings are.
He hasn't seen me compete often, though. What do you say? Do I compete better, worse, or even to what I train?
You compete about as good as you should compete, I think. You know, you bring.
See how he doesn't give the right answer, though.
No, that's exactly right. I give him three options. I'm not like out of this world in competition compared to. I'm kind of steady.
Yeah, but you're definitely like. It's not like you don't do as well as you do like when you're on your best game training for sure.
So are we doing? Screwed. Are we allowing heel hooks in the gi for this match?
Oh, that was all right. Let's get this one last thing. Heel hooks. We mentioned heel hooks in the gi. What do you think about heel hooks in the gi?
You know, I prefer if you're gonna do heel hooks, might as well just do it in no gi. I'm not totally against it. Like, I feel like back in the day, we probably did heel hook each other.
We definitely did,
and we didn't really care about it just because we didn't follow the rules that hard. But is it the worst thing? I don't know if there would be necessarily more injuries, but sometimes it's nice to not have to defend heel hooks all the time. So that's. That's
but don't
where,
you think this is kind of, the evolution of it is kind of changing? Like, think about you.
Yeah.
You weren't doing heel hooks
right
at all until recently, right?
Mm-hmm.
And now you've gotten a better understanding. Your teaching of it has probably gotten way better.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you think there's a way that you could slowly introduce it, show basic fundamentals, and then have specific days where you're like, all right, today, no heel hooks. You know, and then you have those specific training sessions where, all right, we're going to work on heel hooks in the gi, and maybe we could start a movement.
No.
You
heel
tell me
hooks
this. All right, you tell me right now. Right now, you're saying no. But is there an opportunity for it to evolve into heel hooks in the gi? Do you think that is an open path?
I don't see why not. You know,
you disgust me right now.
But like I said, sometimes it's nice having like the different rule sets. Like if you almost think of like sambo versus judo, right? What's the difference in rule sets? In sambo, you're allowed to attack the legs, but you're not allowed to do chokes.
See, why can't we do stuff like that? It's his school.
In sambo, you're not allowed to attack heel hooks.
Whatever, we're not
doing
sambo.
Regardless, judo, you're not allowed to attack legs, but you can do chokes. You know, as far as submission wise, I think in some ways you end up getting like certain parts of your game ends up getting way better because you've restricted techniques. So I think that's in many ways it's a good thing to not have heel hooks in the game. But is it the worst thing in the world to train with heel hooks in the game?
Yes.
The answer to your question is you can try and do whatever you want to me. Heel hooks, neck cranks, twisters. I don't care. You're not going to get me in there. I don't care what you do. In the match, it's going to go like this. I'm going to pull guard. I'm going to sweep. I'm going to over-under. I'm
going to
scarf choke you.
You're going to pull guard now?
Yanni, have you ever seen me not pull guard in a tournament match? Yeah, unless they pull
first. You threatened the takedown on me. No, I'm going to take you down. There's my 2 points, and then I'm going to stall.
Well, that has happened. When I was a white belt, I did get taken down when I didn't want to be. Like, it was, you know, that in-between where, like, I pull, but he was already in the act.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that perfect. Kind of thing. There's my 2 points.
That's the only way you can get
I'm going to stall. There's not enough time for me to get four.
Now, here's the thing. Going back to the leg locks, the leg lock debate here. Here's one thing I will say. I will never hide behind a rules in training and yell at someone for going for a heel hook on me if we're in the gi. I will always defend first and then afterwards say, oh, are we doing heel hooks or not? Because sometimes you have people who are like, say, do mostly MMA or no gi, and then they're putting on the gi, and people sometimes hide behind those rule sets. We're like, hey, this is IBJJF. We can't do reaping and all this stuff. You should always think to protect yourself first. And then of course you want to clarify before, so we're both in the same playing field. But if I'm training with someone new and they start doing a heel hook on me, I will always defend the heel hook, and I will never tell them.
Never take it for granted first. Yeah. You defend it, and then afterwards you can just discuss.
Yeah, we can discuss afterwards, absolutely.
So you just mentioned something. How about reaping? What do you think about reaping in the gi? I like reaps in the gi.
I don't think there's anything really wrong with reaps. I think there are, every once in a while, people get injured with reaps, but I don't think that's necessarily because of reap, because people get hurt posting their hand and twisting their ankle and passing.
So it's more like the reaction of somebody that's not
practicing it. Yeah, I think I think as people get better, they should learn to avoid the reaps anyway, because if someone's reaping you, they're controlling your knee and kind of like slowing you down. You should be always pushing their foot off anyway, never letting their foot come across, because that's where good guard passing happens.
I mean, this plays into my argument where it should be, everything should be legal.
Yeah.
Because it shouldn't be legal back in the day, because there wasn't, people didn't know how to do it right, and people probably would get hurt more. And plus, he was talking about before the stigma. There used to be a stigma with...
There used to be a stigma, Zapatero.
But now it's a little different. I think it's trending in that direction.
I could see why sometimes they have these rules, because for white belts, sometimes their energy levels are uncontrolled, you know? So if they're getting their guard passed, their immediate reaction sometimes is to just throw their legs anywhere they want. And they don't do it softly. They're not like, you know, pushing someone back. They're just throwing the leg down.
So that's what I'm saying.
You get an injury.
You
right
personally...
There.
You can defend it, whatever. But if you see two white belts doing stuff, you'll stop them.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, you won't let them try to figure it out.
Exactly, because that's well, why should I let them figure it out and let them possibly hurt themselves, you know?
But if we're doing, like, you're not going to be doing heel hooks for everybody. It's more like toe holds and stuff. You're going to wait until upper belts. Maybe even just black belt only do heel hooks. You know, I don't see, even if you're saying, if we learn all the safeties and stuff, I feel like it would just add more dynamics to some matches right now, get pretty stuck in 50-50 and stuff. Why not open it up?
I still think that IBJJF should allow heel hooks, no-gi.
Well, we're not talking about no-gi. We're talking about in the gi.
But I'm just saying.
I don't care.
Because you're talking about 50-50. Happens a lot in IBJJF. If no-gi, IBJJF, they had heel hooks, that would slow all that down.
But I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the gi. Yanni, what do you say about that?
Get better at passing 50-50.
I'm honestly open for both ways. I wouldn't be totally against heel hooks.
I'm not saying they change it for everything. But why not open up like a special tournament? Like, all right, this tournament, you know, and start to
absolutely.
Just, you can do the same thing as gi, no gi, and then all no holds barred. You can do whatever you want. This one,
I think
that is what I'm talking about.
The only problem is I don't think a lot of people would be are going to enter those tournaments, other than people who, guys like Gary Tonin and stuff like that like compete in everything.
Right,
you know?
But you got to start somewhere.
Do you think that heel hooks in the gi could end up being more dangerous because of the friction?
Do I think? I don't think they'll be that
wrong.
More dangerous. I don't think that they would be more dangerous. But I do think it is harder to escape them, and maybe people will get injured because you have guys like...
They just don't want to tap.
Vinny Magalhães, who doesn't want to tap, who won't tap.
No, he can just bend his foot that way on his own. You didn't hear him?
He
can't do that with a knee.
He just bend his foot that way.
I think he'd be screaming on the mat if that happened to his knee. For sure.
Yeah, I know.
You get your knee twisted inside out? No way. I want to see it, though.
You
want... Oh, no. You want...
No, because you know what? What do
I'll
you
send you some videos.
All right, this is another one. What do you think about these guys that get caught in these submissions, right? And they're like, yeah, just break it. What do you think about that?
In a tournament?
Yeah, in a tournament. Like, these world-class tournaments. Like, he got you in the move. Like, why not tap? Like, what's the point of, like, let him break it, right? Because if we're simulating a real-life thing, isn't this what this is, a martial art? If he broke your arm, he would probably kill you if he wanted to. If you have one broken arm now,
right? One match that comes to mind is how Henzo let his shoulder break. Now go.
Honestly, it depends on what level of the competition it is. I feel like...
But you're going to lose anyway now because of the break.
If you're going to lose anyway, yeah, you should tap. Absolutely. Right. That's silly. You know, whether or not you should or shouldn't tap. Like, I think...
Even if you were about to win, though. Like, they got you in the position.
Well, if you're about to win, things are different.
I think you should give the person an opportunity to win their match.
Yeah, but remember when Gary Tonin cried out and then that counted as a tap? So as long as you don't make any noise and they snap your foot in half, it's fine. How come he gets to lose because he screamed out?
That's IBJJF rules.
Yeah, it is a rule, you know.
Yeah, but it's the same thing.
It's a verbal tap.
He didn't want
to
tap. He just made a noise. He was surprised. He would have kept going. He wouldn't have stopped. One of those things have to change. That's a contradiction.
It is a little bit of a contradiction because I think in the Gary Tonin situation, it didn't look like he.
This is the wrist lock you're talking
about. Yeah, because here's the thing. There are verbal taps, right? You can say tap.
You can say tap.
And yelling and stuff. Because if you end up like yelling because someone did something, the person may stop pulling on the arm or stop attacking, and then all of a sudden you pull out, and then you kind of give the person a false reset, you know? So it's not fair to, it's not sportsmanlike to allow that. So you have to have that in place. It's like, if you're getting close to getting submitted and you're screaming, that's it. It's a tap.
Like if we're promoting sportsmanship, you having to snap somebody else's arm, I don't think that's good sportsmanship to make them have to do that. I don't want to, like me personally, I'm not trying to hurt anybody when I come in here. I'm trying to giggle and make fun of people and have fun, you know? And I think that's what more we should promote. Like spectators, a casual fan, you think they want to see arms getting broken, feet getting turned inside out?
Yeah, I think spectators love car, crashes.
That's why people watch car crashes. That's right. But what you're talking about, Ed, is in the training room. Nobody should be breaking anyone in the training room.
That's a given. I'm talking about on the mats, like the guys we look up to, you know?
When you're at that level, though, it's up to them. I think they have put enough time that they can make that decision for themselves. So I respect that. I respect if they want to get their arm broken and
they definitely should have tapped, because now we were just talking about Vinny. Vinny's going to be out for how long because of that break?
Yeah, absolutely.
How long was Henzo out for because of his break?
I just think it's an ego thing. I don't support the ego of that.
But they lost anyway. If they were going to win, then it's different. But if you're going to lose,
there's been guys that were going to win.
Yeah, for sure. They let it happen. I mean,
almost. What's his name? Who's the most famous guy that got his foot turned inside out? It wasn't Vinny. It was somebody else.
You're talking about Humalo?
Yeah, Humalo.
Oh, right.
He was he didn't win that match, did he? He was close to winning when he let the
Yeah, he lost anyway, right.
But that was it was close. Like, there was a reason, like, all right, I could win.
Yeah.
But Humalo's had a history of not tapping in leg locks. Do you remember when Flavio Almeida heel hooked him in 2007? He let his knee explode.
Absolutely. He's been...
He stayed in that same position, let that knee explode, and then went to the next match and couldn't walk.
It's a bummer. It's a bummer, I know. I mean, sometimes, and you always feel bad for them, too. But I think the pros, they've earned the right to make that decision, though. They put in the hours that we haven't, that they could be like, okay, I'd rather get my leg broken or whatever. I don't think it's a good idea. And in fact, I think one of the recent Zoom sessions when we were breaking down one of the ADCC matches with these two girls, Fionn Davies versus
Bia Mesquita.
So Bia Mesquita is like the most winningest female competitor of all time, probably, you know, has more world championships than anyone else. And she's beaten Fionn a number of times.
Right.
And then she made a mistake. Fionn jumped on her into a reverse triangle armbar. And man, she waited way too long.
Way too long. That arm looked like a pretzel.
And at that point, it's like, listen, you've already lost. Just tap, you know?
Right. That's what I don't understand.
It is an ego thing for sure. 100%. Because she might think, oh, I might get out of this and win it.
Was she winning up to that point?
I think it was early enough in the match that there might not have been points.
I just think I'm never going to be at that level or even close. But when you have students, you do, or if I have people that I work a lot with, I'd like to show them that it's fine. Yeah. It's all right.
That's true. But you know what? Sometimes you got to deal with that adversity, man. Sometimes things don't work the way, things don't happen the way
you
should
be. There's a line. There's a line. I just think I wouldn't go to even close to the line that they go to. If somebody got me, you know, they got me. I'm going to learn from it, and I'll be able to train tomorrow. And
that's the big thing.
That's what I like about it. That's what I would rather have, that them promote that kind of mentality than a warrior, like, kind of, because we're not a, I don't.
But then sometimes you have the fun of the crazy story. Be like, yo, this guy was crazy. He bridged me off and jumped on my head. But it makes you feel alive. That's part of what jiu-jitsu is, what makes jiu-jitsu great. It's real.
I guess. It's from my perspective, it just doesn't make any sense.
I think there is an ideal. We should all be going towards that ideal. But we are all individuals. You know, there's some people that are hyper-aggressive. There's some people that are more passive. And that's what.
Have you ever not tapped to a submission and let something be injured because of it?
Oh, of course. When I was a white belt, I have a great story of I trained with some guy that I never met before. He was bigger, and he apparently he was pretty decent. He knew some moves, but I just assumed he was brand new. I was a white belt too. He like put me in a headlock, Kesa Katami.
I told him about this.
And then he did the Americana armbar, right? So the problem with that, the thing about that position is that the Gracie's always taught us that this is an easy move to escape from, and you can't get submitted from a headlock kind of thing. At that time, you know, I'm like just a white belt thinking like, oh, okay. Then he starts putting me in this armbar, which I didn't really respect or didn't really know where I was in danger. And he definitely arched his hips, and my arm popped. I waited another couple seconds, and then I was like, all right, I guess I'll tap. And then he's like, you all right? And I was like, yeah. Of course, I'm not going to say that. And I kept rolling, and then I wasn't able to roll for like at least 2-3 weeks after that. My arm could not even extend like past like.
Now, was that the only time?
Only time I could really think of that. Like, there's been times where I've got injured from a submission because it happened too fast.
No, but I meant specifically something that you didn't tap, that you should have tapped.
Are you going conscious or something because you're just fighting it too long?
I mean, I've been put to sleep.
Yeah, of course. You're going to fight a choke longer, yeah, right? Why not fight a choke longer?
Yeah. I don't think... It hasn't happened too many times. That one definitely sticks out in my mind because it was a learning experience for me.
You must have got through to me somehow because I've only not tapped once.
Yeah.
And it's because I'm just unfamiliar with toe holds.
Yeah.
Like he had it and I didn't know. And he didn't break it, but he popped it. But other than that, I tap super. Yeah. I'm hard to tap, but when you have me, you have me. I'll tap way early. Nothing hurts me ever.
So now you've been put to sleep. How many times have you put someone to sleep? And do you have a memory that stands out in your mind?
He's got notches on his belt.
I've heard stories of people waking up and doing all kinds of weird things. Do you have like a crazy story of someone that should have tapped that you put to sleep? Or if I see somebody starting to go out,
or somebody that you hate and you're like, I'm putting this guy out.
No, I mean, one time I put someone to sleep at back in the day on the Fridays at Denville, and I forget his name, but he was tough. He was like a football player. I think he was still in high school too. I want to say he was probably like a senior, but very big and strong. And always fought everything to the end. And I remember he had this like idea that you could just like push the elbow off or like pull the arm off real easy. And he would use that a lot. And I would roll with him very technically. I wouldn't try to like force anything. And then like two or three times he like used his little tactic to just like force my arms off of him. And then on the third time I just hit my arm. And then he just went really hard to try to yank, so I had to squeeze. And then I realized that he was making a gurgling noise. And at the time I was a little heated, I was a little annoyed. And then and then I saw that he was sleeping. I was like, oh man, I can't believe I had to do this to him. And then I didn't even check on him. I just let him wake up on his own. And he looked at me a few seconds later, his eyes were all bloodshot. He's like, did I tap? And I was like, no.
So if you roll with him today, would it be the same or different?
Do I?
Would you really go for it, or would you just let him out of it?
I think I probably would make sure that he's going to tap, though. I don't think I would let him out. I don't like giving people a way out of bad technique, you know? So obviously, if it's an arm bar or something like that, I'm not going to break someone's arm. But if it's a choke, I'm going to be like, make sure you tap, please. And I've been choked a bunch of times. I know that's probably not good to get choked unconscious. I mean, we don't have enough data, I think. But
yeah, they're starting to figure out that it's actually not a freebie.
Yeah. I used to think like, oh, no big deal. But, you know, I've been dropped in like Taekwondo and stuff too, and probably found out that I had probably had a concussion and stuff. It's actually a very similar feeling, actually, if you get dropped by a kick and like you're just like out of it. And then it's the same feeling you get when you got choked out. You're just like, wait a second. Oh, that's right. We were just training.
Ed, have you ever choked anyone to sleep or been put to sleep yourself?
No, I haven't done either.
You haven't done either? Have you been close and just been close. Like, all right,
I've
dummy,
seen,
and let go?
I've seen the black come, start to come, and then I'll tap.
But how about putting someone to sleep? Have you seen them like starting to go out and you're like, all right, I'm letting go because
right, one
you're
time,
too stupid to
one
tap?
Time, I was in my basement messing around with my brother. I was standing behind him, and I just put the rear naked on him. Just I wasn't squeezing or nothing, and I would... Squeeze a little, let it go. And then he like kind of dropped.
Oh, wow.
He went like, it was like kind of half out. I felt really terrible about that.
That's actually, yeah, I guess it's just cumulative. It's like you cut it off and he never got the oxygen back, and then you're just cutting it off again.
I don't do stuff like that anymore. That was a long time ago.
Yeah, I've never been put to sleep. I will tap out. And if I've seen anyone so close that it looks like they're going out, I always let go of the submission. Yeah. So Yanni, you're mean.
Yeah, well, the truth is I couldn't really it's not like I could see like that he was getting choked
out.
Yeah,
no, I'm just kidding.
You know, I'm surprised that hasn't happened to me because I do scarf chokes a lot.
Yeah.
And you really can't
people
get a
don't
measure.
Respect those.
Well, not
yeah.
only that,
oh, yeah.
you can't really
you
get
can't
a measure
see.
What's going on. I can't
yeah.
see because my I'm on you. But when I do it wrong because when I get people, it's usually a neck crank.
They're usually tapping the pain around.
Yeah,
the
pain.
That scarf choke is very
does
tight. You've never submitted
some people
me.
Tell me different things. Like I think I've done it to her. Ray or something, and they were just like, ugh. Like afterwards,
and they're just like, ugh.
Yeah.
And then you
I do feel
bad
about that, but not really because I need a way out of this role.
Yeah,
it's my only way out. The scarf joke. Oh, you gotta. How does that hurt your fingers?
I don't know.
My fingers hurt from spider guard, not from scarf jokes. Like this kind of grip, like a
That's
pistol grip, doesn't hurt, but the
actually, you know what? Word. I don't use it too often, but when I was using it, like once or twice. I like felt in my fingers and I was like, I'm not going to do this choke.
Oh, it's so cheap. It's such an easy way out of a roll. Especially if you've never done it to him before.
I remember the first time Ed hit me with that and the last time. And
last.
All the times
what are you
in
talking
between.
About? A bunch of times. That's one of
the
my
last. That's never going to happen again.
Kurt Pellegrino did it in one of those tournaments, the show matches.
Oh, really?
I think we were watching it together. One of those Metamorphs. Not one of the, whatever they're doing.
Fight to win. Wait, is that he did it to the Judo Steve guy?
Oh, really?
Yeah,
scarf choke. It's nice. Legit. It's a legit move.
It is, absolutely. You see Tynan Dalpra from AOJ? He's been using it.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yeah. He uses it a lot.
He uses it?
Ed showed him.
Yeah.
Ed showed him that move.
You know, they're big on the baseball bat choke. It's a similar movement. It's just a different...
That's why I'm good at it. That's where we started. Well, not baseball bat. I started with the... remember we showed the Bravo choke?
Yeah.
I was big on that for a long time. And this is very similar.
Yeah, absolutely. You're using the lapel the same way. But the finish, like the finishing pressure is similar to a baseball bat choke because you're driving on your toes, dropping your head all the way across.
That's right. So that's going to be the move that I use in the tournament against Ed.
Oh, good.
I've never been scarf choked and I never will be.
Are you going to look at the crowd and be like, count to 10?
I can't even understand why you would want a crowd of people there.
Why not? People are going to laugh. They might as well laugh in person. I'll feed off the laughter.
How?
It's going to drive me to be better.
I guess the next time, sure.
No, Dave rises, that time.
Maybe Dave rises to the occasion.
Listen, H, you're going to be my second challenge match if you keep talking this way to me.
Oh, my God. That's so funny. I think that would be even funnier.
Like me and Dave having
just
a challenge,
like,
challenge match?
You just try to see how many positions you can get. Like, try to get every position on him. At least you do it like that. No subs for Yanni.
No, you know what he's going to do? He's going to take my back from Turtle. Has he done that to you? He goes to Turtle, and then you're like, oh, I'm going to get the back. And then all of a sudden he's on your back?
He has done that to me before.
Yeah.
Not anymore.
I need the details for that.
For sure he's done.
Are you doing privates right now?
I haven't done any privates, but...
Are you open to it?
Possibly.
All right, I'll be in touch. Don't facepalm when I text you.
All right.
How many privates do you think it would take Dave to beat me? with you.
Privates with you, H. That's the key ingredient.
That's the key. How many privates would it take you for him to beat me? Let's play this game, too.
Oh, that's...
How many privates would it take for you to think that I have deserved my brown belt?
I don't know.
He doesn't want to answer that.
We talked about it. You had to answer the questions.
No. It's he can't calculate that. It's too much math. He can't do it on the spot.
I'll get you a calculator.
Answer the first question. How many privates with Dave before you were confident that he would beat me?
Yeah, but I don't think privates and even knowledge is really going to be the what's going to...
Really? What is it then?
I think it's just going to be just more rolling and getting the skills
down.
You're
telling me privates with you would not even help him at all?
No, it wouldn't help him at all. I probably could help him with a few things.
But you don't think you could bring him to the pinnacle? You think he has to do it on his own?
I think privates are good, but I feel that it's just training that really is where you get your biggest strides, you know? I think privates like help fill in the little gaps. It's like, oh, I'm right here. I'm about to figure it out or whatever. And then,
that's interesting.
Then you get the privates to help.
I didn't think about it that way. I thought that like, well, you see all these celebrities, like maybe they just do one-on-ones. They get good just doing one-on-one privates with the guy. But they probably roll too with...
Yeah, they probably have to do other training. If you're going to get good, I think knowledge by itself is only...
All right, how about this? What would it take? What would you do? Say, all right, you're coaching Dave to be...
Money's on the line.
Yeah, money's on the line for you. You'll lose your school if he loses.
I have to win.
Yeah.
Now
you
what?
Have to
yeah,
win.
What would you do?
I would definitely have to make a camp and put Dave in lots of bad positions.
How long is this camp?
Yeah, how long is
this
camp?
Is it 1 year? Is it 2 years? How many years is this camp?
All right, let Yanni see the first match. You'll see the match.
No, honestly, you can get good really fast if you do like
good.
A really...
Yeah, he can get good, but to be me, though.
To do a specialized camp, I mean, you can do it in like maybe 6 weeks or something like that.
Thank you. So Ed's only 6 weeks ahead of me.
Big mistake. You can't get him to beat me in 6 weeks.
Ed's only 6 weeks ahead of me is what you're saying.
No way. No way.
He does
you know
have
that.
One stripe,
yeah,
and I have right, no stripe.
I'll give you a chance
so
to take that back.
That that's fair.
You take that back.
No.
Six weeks, no way.
Yanni said I'm only 6 weeks behind you.
I'm saying it's possible to get it done in 6 weeks.
No, don't
change.
No, you don't jumble your words because of Ed now, all right? You said I'm only 6 weeks behind Ed.
He didn't say that.
Ed gets his black belt. I get my black belt in 6 weeks after that, and then that's good.
That's not quite what I said.
What does this 6 week entail? Like, how many days a week are you working with him specifically?
It's 5 days, 7 days a week for 6 weeks.
Basically, it's going to be full-time training, you know?
So we're talking about, like, 100 classes or something.
You'd have to train, like, morning and night. We have to get a bunch of people.
Oh, yeah, this makes more sense. Okay, I get it. He's way behind me. He needs a professional camp.
I'm not saying... I got to make sure he's definitely going to win.
You know, we haven't trained in a while, H. Maybe I'm better now.
Maybe.
You're gonna beat the king of layoffs after a layoff? What are you crazy?
But everything's on the line here. I got to make sure I put you in the right training.
If I was under you, H, what belt would I be right now?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know.
My God.
Just notice that he did not say brown belt right off the bat.
No, he didn't say brown. He didn't even say purple belt. Would I be a purple belt under you, H?
Pause. Pause for effect.
I don't know. I don't like answering those questions.
What do you mean? I know I ask you this one all the time.
I know.
Wait, how do you think about your students? How do you know when to promote? Is there just some kind of
when they
beat
tap
that goes
Dave,
over your
they
head?
Get their blue belt?
Yes. No, I'm just kidding. Basically, I just kind of work on them on an individual basis. When I start seeing they're making the, like certain strides in their own game, you know,
right? Because everybody's got different game. Nobody plays the same game here.
I don't like match people up with each other. I can't say like this guy happens to always beat the other guy, so he's definitely going to get promoted before him. It's usually like, oh, wow, this person...
Yeah, but why did you give me a brown belt? I wasn't training a lot when I got it.
Because I got my brown belt.
Yeah.
Right?
That's why you had to
give him his brown belt because I had my brown belt.
I don't even remember.
It was almost 5 years ago.
Now, listen, I have a student, all right? This student, he needs a lot of work, all right? We're just going to call him Ron, all right? But at a certain point, I feel bad for him because he's not getting it. So I think I am going to award him his next belt soon. How do you feel about that? Do things like that?
I think you should always be promoting him when you see real improvement. That doesn't necessarily have to be at the standards that you would put for the person who's like competing and winning all the time or the younger person or... But they have to see some strides in their game, I think.
So then you might have given me my brown belt.
Yeah, absolutely.
See, perfect. But so then I should just probably one day promote Ron, even though he's not getting it, is what you're saying.
Even though he's terrible?
Yes.
No, Yanni doesn't do stuff like that. I would have my black belt a long time ago if he did stuff like that.
No, I always try to, and I do believe that people will get better if they really put the effort in, and I try to reward them when they are making that effort, you know?
You still believe that after training with me all these years?
Yeah.
Do you think there's a difference, though? Like, blue, purple, brown promotions are important, but is there something extra that you're looking for black, just for the future, for any students that you're going to promote to black belt? Is it involve off-the-mat things as well?
Yeah.
Like the way they carry themselves.
Yeah, I do think that the way you carry yourself is important because people do look up to you, you know? People are going to have certain expectations. You don't have to be the toughest on the mat, but you have to have a base, you know, a really solid understanding and an open mind, and also be very mature about everything, you know? Definitely, like, when if a person's having a problem with, like, attitude or whatever it is, like maybe they have a bad energy, I try to get them to, I would try to believe that they should be past that, you know, understand that there is more to training, more to your experience and your whole role in this community than just the belt you have around the waist or the number of people you tap, whether or not you get your guard pass and stuff like that. That's not really...
That's perfect. That's exactly how I would end this, because this is what we're trying to do here off the mats, is try to build the community. That's what we want to do. Build as big a community, friendships that last forever, learning that's out off the mats, on the mats, just to be better.
All while being silly and having fun.
Absolutely. And we all have our place in it too. Absolutely.
All right. With that, you got any last thoughts?
Any last thoughts?
No. Are you going to do this again?
I think I would do this again. This was fun. Yeah, absolutely. Right? Yeah.
Have you listened to any of the podcasts?
Yeah, all three of them.
Do you enjoy them?
Yeah, they're fun.
Are you just saying that because I'm sitting right in front of you?
Probably.
Was the last episode your favorite?
Oh, yeah. The last one was great.
All right. There it is. Hopefully, everybody sees it the way I see it. Yanni likes me better than Dave. I'm better than Dave in everything, in all ways. And Dave, you say?
Maybe you're a little bit better, but only 6 weeks better.
Definitely not what he said.
That's exactly what he said. So I'm right on your coattails.
You're going to do a 6-week training camp with him? You're going to close your school down 6 weeks?
No, he's going to come to me.
He's never, ever going
to
do that.
Yes, you're going to come here and teach, and he's going to come
Yanni,
to me for 6 weeks.
You would have to pay Yanni $10,000 a week for the 6 weeks for him to possibly even consider doing that.
$10,000 a week? What are you talking about?
He's not coming to your school
every
day.
He's
going
to volunteer his time.
Yanni's got all this stuff he's working on. Tell him what Yanni's working on.
Oh, Yanni is working on all kinds of content for his students and others. You guys make sure that you check him out on Up Top Martial Arts on YouTube. Also, at Up Top Martial Arts on Instagram and Facebook.
So you just proved my point. He's got no time for you. Once Jiu-Jitsu starts up again, he's going to be training twice a day. We're going to be doing future stuff with him. He's got no time to train you. You will always be worse than me.
He wants to see you humiliated, so he's going to teach me.
It's kind of a win-win for him because we can't lose in the situation. It's all fun. But if he had to pick, he said already that he would like me to win.
No, he didn't say he would like you to win. He said he would like me to win, but you will probably win.
That's what I inferred from it.
And it's not 100%. It's a probably.
All right, well, we would love... Listen, I would love to hear what everybody else thinks. Who they think's going to win. You want to start a poll on that? It's going to be embarrassing.
We can put a poll. Make sure that you guys email us tothedeathpodcast@gmail.com. Also, follow us on all social media @tothedeathpodcast on Instagram, on Twitter, and on Facebook.
Yeah, so make sure you subscribe to all Yanni's stuff, not just YouTube. Go to Up Top Martial Arts Facebook. Go to Yanni himself's Facebook. And make sure you pay attention to what he's doing, because this is just the beginning. The YouTube videos are going to become unbelievable. I know for a fact. So I'd also like to thank our sponsor, Core BJJ. Make sure you follow them at Core BJJ.
NJ.
NJ. Facebook, YouTube.
And the website, CoreBJJNJ.com. We would also like to thank Rob for the music.
And that is it for this episode. Hopefully we'll have Yanni back again. He said maybe. That's the best you're going to get from Yanni. You don't get yeses or nos. You get maybe. I'll think about it. So if you guys want to see Yanni back on the podcast, make sure you let him know, let us know, and we'll make it happen.
All right. Thank you, everybody. This is
To the Death Podcast. Did you like that?
No, not at all. Definitely not.
All right, this is To the Death podcast. Thank you.